It's WCW Prime. Hi, everyone. I'm Chris Cruz, along with the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And Dusty, the entire wrestling world remains shocked, stunned, and even saddened by what happened at Halloween Havoc, Jimmy Hart turning on Hulk Hogan.
Well, it was a situation to where you couldn't find your friends without a program. There were times to where Luger, I say, don't be trusting Luger. I say, don't be trusting Flair. Sting can't trust nobody. And now Hulkamania is left out in the cold out there. We have not heard the last from him. Speaking of last from him, I went on record last week talking about my man Boone going to be here wrestling this week. And I look around the dressing room and there was a sign that say extras. Not like star on the door. And I went in and say, Boone! And that was Big Train Butt. And Big Train Butt said, I got Boone to go to the store. And he won't be back for 2 hours. So I'm now the Prime Catch of the Week.
All right, now we take you to the ring. The Canadian Crippler, Chris Benoit.
Chris Benoit.
Well, we promised a great show on Prime, Dusty, and that is exactly what we have got here. What a debut that Chris Benoit has made here in World Championship Wrestling, stunning the wrestling world with his abilities.
Well, he has so much ability, so much speed, so much endurance. We're going to see what he's got for Cobra right here on WCW Prime.
You know, as big and rough and tough as Chris Benoit is, can he deal with a man who's nearly 275 pounds?
Uh-oh. What is that?
That's listen. Morse code.
Morse code. Did it?
Mr. Putin, from Langley, Virginia.
Did it?
275.
Don't even try it. No, don't even try it.
Oh, here he comes.
You already got me on that one, and it's not going to happen again. And Cobra, you better be careful turning his back to Chris Benoit. Benoit can fly everywhere. He better get in that ring and attend to business. A salute. Oh, look out.
Oh, man, he cracked him right off the bat. And the ditto did wasn't even over yet.
Holy smokes. Cobra, as you would say, is getting a mud hole stomped
in him. Very good, very nice.
A
mud hole stomach going on.
In real life, I find that sometimes I start talking in rhodisms.
Hey, did they ring the bell on this thing?
Well, no, that's just the point. I mean, the bell has not even rung. This match has not even begun. Look out. Oh, Benoit.
What?
Just whips the Cobra into that security railing. No, the bell is not wrong, so Benoit, I guess, technically can't be disqualified here.
Well, the referee went outside and said, throw him in. Oh, there he is. Call for the bell. A day late and a dolly short there, Anderson.
Well, that's the bell. Cobra, oh, look out. A full Nelson. He powers him over. 1, 2, and 3. I can't believe it.
This is
unbelievable. And we're back in a moment here in the Prime. What a kickoff match.
Unbelievable.
Hi, I'm Flying Brian. You're watching me right here, live and technical on Prime Wrestling.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following six-man tag team match is set for one fall. Introducing first, from Clearwater, Florida, Mark Starr. His tag team partner from Tampa, Florida, Frankie Lancaster. And their partner from Texas City, Texas,
it's two Floridians and a Texan, but what chance do they have against the team that we're about to see in this six-man tag match?
Well, I'll tell you what, this is a fine-looking group of young athletes right here at WCW, and they got as good a chance as anybody against these guys. Man, I never thought I would see it, but the return of the Four Horsemen.
And that is a scary thought for every wrestler here in WCW. Now it's back to the ring.
Their opponents, representing the Horsemen, first from Charlotte, North Carolina, Nature Boy, Red Fuller. His tag team partner from Minnesota, the Enforcer, Paul Anderson. And their partner from Hollywood, California, Ryan Bryan.
Well, they're all smiles, but what a disgusting situation that ensued as a direct result of their actions at Halloween Havoc, highlights of which we'll see in a moment here on the Prime, Dust.
Well, there was no trust ever for me in the Nature Boy Ric Flair. I said on numerous occasions, 11 never changes his spot We have seen Iron Anderson Pillman putting this thing together. I believe I seen it coming. I called the shot. Never knowing though, Sting now felt the wrath of the Nature Boy Ric Flair, and once again the Horseman ride on WCW.
We're also going to hear from Eugene Okerlund in the World War III Control Center. Our first look at our next big pay-per-view coming up just a few weeks, actually. So we'll be keeping you up to date on that. Eugene Okerlund standing by. Now the collar and elbow tie-up. Mark Starr with a hammerlock there on Flying Brian Pillman. And what will Pillman do to break out of it? Well, that's what he'll do. He'll throw an elbow.
Ooh. Well, these three guys need to, you know, like you said, what chance do they have? They have a chance if they use their speed and quickness in and out. But once you get in that situation to where Pillman or Iron Anderson or Nature Boy Ric Flair get you in a defensive mode, then you ain't got a chance. Nice shot right there.
Mark Starr, who has spent some time wrestling in Japan and is now actually an 11-year veteran, has got to find a way to break out of the pack. And one of the ways, I think, is to be on a team that defeated a team of Flying Brian Pillman, Ric Flair, and Arn Anderson. Let's see. Pretty evenly matched so far. That's young Barry Houston in here. Oh, pull the trunks. Boy, does he run into another left there by Arn Anderson. And in comes the Nature Boy.
Yeah, they call him the dirtiest player in the game, and that is truly a fact. The Nature Boy Ric Flair now back leading the Horseman. Iron Anderson once again walking behind. And once again, Brad Pillman playing the part of the third man out. And I'm going to tell you what's going to happen there. The fourth guy in the mix, my friend.
There is a fourth guy. We don't know who it is.
I know who it is.
You do know who it is.
Yes.
And who is that?
I'm not at liberty to tell you at this time.
I wouldn't be surprised if it's Dusty Rhodes.
Oh, yeah, sure.
You're the fourth horseman.
No, yeah, I'm the fourth horseman, and you're a horse of that. Well, you know what I'm talking about.
You know, in all seriousness, the horseman on two or three separate occasions came very close to ending your professional wrestling career. What is there to say that the horsemen have forgotten that you exist and won't try to end your broadcast career? That is something that a lot of people, a lot of wrestlers have to be concerned
about.
Well,
what do you think I surround myself with such big men like you for? If the horsemen come in the broadcast booth to pick on me, you will give them my Rocky, my Aki's karate combo sandwich and take care of the dream. Diane would hit him with a clipboard. I wouldn't be in no problem. They wouldn't lay a finger on the American dream. Right here. Nice shot. That's Mr. Lancaster.
That's Frankie Lancaster. You're right. That's Frankie Lancaster.
Of course
Lancaster.
I'm right. Oh! And Pillman caught him on the back of the head. The spine buster. That does it.
What?
That does it. It's right.
Arn Anderson didn't go for the pin. He said, finish him, Nate.
Well, sure. He's the walk behind the steal.
And Anderson and Pillman come in and deal with Mark Starr and Barry Houston.
The match. Nature Boy Ric Flair, Flying Brian,
big
and the enforcer, Arn Anderson.
Oh, man, I tell you.
He's looking crazier than ever before.
Crazier than a lunabug.
All right, that is three of the four horsemen. As we said, they dominated wrestling in the 80s and are seeking to do the same thing in this, the last half of the last decade of this century. We'll see this again, Dusty, you fourth horseman, you, as Anderson
well, right here,
Frankie Lancaster in.
And Lancaster, the boat went over and caught him in the face coming back off the rope. And he caught him right here. Boom, brother. Zoom, bow. Bam and wham. The horseman once again, yes, walk behind it. Get on out. I thought you had some spine. Prove me wrong, didn't you, Iron? And now the famous big and full leg like a pride by the leader of the Hoffman, the Nature Boy Ric Flair, the dirtiest player in the game.
Still to come, the Star Blazer, his debut, and next, we'll take you back and look at Halloween Havoc when Prime continues in a moment. Action here on WCW Prime, and what a tag team this is. No, we're not talking about the Southern Posse. We'll see them in this segment, but we're talking about Alex Freud and Eddie Guerrero. And Dusty, you know, these two guys have been opponents in the past.
Hey, what do you mean? Are they putting down the Southern Posse?
Oh, I wasn't putting them down.
Yeah, you were.
I just meant
you said, oh, and by the way, the Southern Posse, Travis and Tripp, is that right?
Travis and Tripp.
What is it?
I don't know their names.
Nobody ever tells me anything.
I just make it up.
We'll call them. Trust me, I know them both.
We'll call them Dusty and
Cody.
Right before I went on the air, they told me, they said, I know you're mad at Boone for leaving. Yes, Johnny Boone's nowhere.
And you made him almost a semi-star. It's like you're semi-good-looking. And then they said to me, we're going to make you proud today on TV. I said, I don't even like you guys. Make me proud. He said, we're going to pull an upset over the Wonder Kid and Eddie Guerrero. So let's see what happens. That's insight. I'm bringing you insight on the prime.
Why do these wrestlers talk to you and not to me?
Why? Oh, man. You are not allowed in the dressing area.
Why not?
Because.
Oh, it's a, what is this, a parent, a father-son relationship here now?
No, you're not
allowed. I got that growing up all the time.
Why, Dad?
Because.
Why?
Because.
What?
Because I said so.
What's your match?
All right, watch this.
Wow. He caught him in the back of his neck.
What hang time?
Eddie Guerrero.
Now the whip on the Southern Posse.
I'm just trying to sound like you.
You're getting animation.
Animated.
One, two, and... Hey, that was kind of a tap out there by the Southern Posse.
Well, they have been together a lot longer than Eddie Guerrero and Alex Wright have been together, but they aren't doing too well in this situation.
Going up top, high-risk maneuver, Mr. Chris Cruz. Oh, man!
Got him!
The frog splash.
What?
He didn't get it. That's called a frog splash.
Frog.
Yes.
Bud.
Oh, I get you. And Guerrero picks up the Southern Posse member and slams him. He's got a lot. Whoa. What was that?
Beautiful move.
That was not a beautiful move. That was a mistake, and you know it. Alex Wright showing his inexperience.
Well, the inexperience was it was not as clean as the frog jump, as you said, but the bottom line was it was effective because he got him and nailed him, and our experience was, yeah, it was pretty poor. Yes, what am I beating around the bush? It was a horrible move. Luckily, though, the Southern Posse was down and out, and right there's a good move now.
Yeah.
There you go. Make a bad one, make two good ones.
Well, that's the thing.
I went through that here.
Yeah.
I had two bad ones, Eric and Garth, and now hopefully I got a good one here. You know what I mean? Ready on the prime, man.
Nice suplex. I think that show, one, two, and a kick out. Dusty, in all seriousness, though, I think that shows that Alex is not afraid to fail, that he's not going to hit every single move.
No, let me talk about you, Mr. Broadcaster. That is so true. We said that about him when losing things. He's not afraid to fail. At his age, you shouldn't be afraid of anything. You know what I mean? So the bottom line is that when he makes a move like that, he only learns from it.
Yeah.
And Eddie Guerrero is too smooth, brother. And I've heard people say time for time the best wrestler in the world. Close, if not the, my friend.
Nice suplex there. It is tough, I think, anybody would suffer in comparison to Eddie Guerrero. But Alex Wright is in there at just 20 years old, a former teenage sensation. Let's see if he can graduate into becoming a strong, effective young man.
Hey, Alex,
World Championship Wrestling.
Yes, yes. He's very clean.
And now the double whip. Look out. Alex Wright at about 6 feet. Oh, he ducks under. What's it?
He got one. Got the other. It's a double slew foot.
A what?
A double slew foot. Kicked them both in the belly welly. And now they're throwing one of the Southern Posse in. It's going to put him to waste.
Now the frog jump might come into play. Alex Wright is handling most of the load here. And it is a heavy load when you talk about the Southern Posse. Uh-oh, look out. Hey, look at that. Miss Larry and Eddie Guerrero. He comes up with his own.
Very nice teamwork by these guys. Very nice.
This, as you pointed out, Dusty, from two men who have never been a team before.
Oh, man.
He's got to be unconscious. One, two, and three.
They had some great teamwork.
Eddie Guerrero and Alex Wright, who in recent weeks here in World Championship Wrestling have had some tremendous battles, in fact, against themselves, have put that all aside, having great respect for one another, and look at the team they have become, handily defeating the Southern Posse. But what happens when they meet guys like the Harlem Heat, Arn Anderson, and Flying Brian Pillman?
Well, I'll tell you right here, pound, boy. They nailed him with the froggy jump, and then some great teamwork right here. Nice drop kick. Eddie Guerrero hooks him up right here, and Alex Wright goes up to the top and comes off, like you say, with so much power and speed. And yes, using the speed and the quickness, we see Alex Wright and Eddie Guerrero take a big win right here on WCW Prime.
And the action continues in a moment here on the Prime Vehicle in the World War III Control Center.
Dusty, now we take you to your friend.
Who's that?
Mean Gene Okerlund.
Yes! Mean Gene! Take it away! Right here! From the Prime.
In the World War III Control Center.
Hi again, everyone. Halloween Havoc is history. Now we're on our way to Norfolk, Virginia, and the scope 3 weeks from this Sunday night for another blockbuster. It's WCW's World War III on Sunday, November the 26th, and available exclusively on pay-per-view. Listen to this. For the very first time ever, a three-ring, 60-man, over-the-top rope battle royal with the winner. That's the last man left in the ring to get a shot at the WCW Heavyweight Championship currently held by Hulk Hogan. Now, here are the first names signed for this extraordinary 60-man event. Sting, Lex Luger, the Macho Man, Randy Savage, over 500 pounds, the Shark, Disco Inferno, Big Bubba, VK Wall Street, Arn Anderson, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, Ric Flair, Sergeant Craig Pittman, Mr. Wonderful, Johnny B. Bad, and the Harlem Heat. We're going to have more participants next week. In each of those three rings, by the way, there will be a giant from the Dungeon of Doom. In one ring, the Son of Andre. In the second ring, Yeppe, who made his dramatic appearance at last Sunday's Halloween Havoc. And in ring number three, a man reported to be well over 7 feet tall, discovered by the master. All three giants prepared to go into battle at World War III. Now, in addition to the Battle Royal, Lex Luger will lock up in a return from Detroit with the Macho Man, Randy Savage. I've got both men standing by. Let's get their comments.
WCW, pay-per-view, the total package, World War III. This is where I get to tie up all the loose ends. When you talk about a loose end, you're talking about a loose cannon. You're talking about the Macho Man, Randy Savage, the man who's paranoid, filled with delusions about where my motors are, where my integrity. Macho Man, I'm going to take you apart in World War III, and then I'm going to breeze through the 60-man battle royal and get my title shot that I deserve.
Luger, I was right about you all along. Total package, don't be planning on getting into that World War III 60-man, three-ring battle royal. You're not going to make it, because you and me are going to have an explosion earlier in the evening. You still got to get a short fuse? Well, you're right, and it's already lit, and it's going to explode in your face. And the only one walking in there to grab that brass ring out of the sky is the Macho Man, Randy Savage. Total package, I know where you're coming from. I guessed it all along, but now I know for sure it's your last match in WCW, because I'm going to get you, yeah!
There is a lot of heat between those two men, the Total Package and the Macho Man. Plus, for the first time in many years, WCW will play host to four of Japan's greatest women wrestlers as Bull Nakata and Akira Hakuto meet Cutie Suzuki and Mayumi Ozaki. It sounds like an eye chart at a sushi bar. Huh, just kidding. It's going to be a tremendous international spectacular. Three-ring, 60-man battle royal. The top superstars from all over the planet. Live from Norfolk, Virginia, and the scope. It's World War III, just 3 weeks from this Sunday, November the 26th, available on pay-per-view, home satellite courtesy Turner Premier, and on DirecTV. One way or another, join us for World War III.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
It's the ultimate challenge, Crossfire.
Crossfire, you get caught up in the crossfire.
Crossfire.
Just a reminder, when you need them, we got them. Big A, America's parts pros.
Here's new croissant pockets from Hot Pockets brand.
Sandwiches stuffed with ham and cheddar and a tender flaky crust. Mmm, croissant pockets.
World War III exclusively on pay-per-view Sunday, November the 26th. And ladies and gentlemen, 60 men in a big battle royal, three rings. 20 men in each ring, including a giant per ring. And I can think of a lot of combinations, gentlemen, that could come up. I've got with me at this time the American Male, Scotty Riggs, and you, Marcus Alexander Bagwell. You know, it's conceivable the two of you could be the last two men in this battle royal, and you'd be going up against each other.
I mean, Gene, you're exactly right. That's something that I hope does not happen. What I do hope happens is me and Scotty can work together to get to the ending. It'd be a great accomplishment just to make it somewhere at the end. But I tell you what, three giants and three rings, it sounds a little scary.
You know, I should point out the winner of this one. You want to talk about high-stakes poker. The winner of this one, ultimately, to get a shot at the WCW World Heavyweight Champion. Scotty Riggs, tag team action going very good for you and your partner, but this is a whole new ball game.
This is something that's impossible to think of. Three giants, three rings, World War III. It's all happening here in WCW. Me and Marcus could conceivably go against each other, but you never know. The excitement, the possibilities. But I'm telling you what, a shot at the World's Heavyweight Championship?
I said high stakes poker. The only way a man can be eliminated is to be thrown up over the top rope out onto the arena floor. Not through the ropes, not out onto the ring apron, but over the top rope onto the floor.
Well, me and Gene, everybody's dream in World Championship Wrestling, of course, is to be the world champion. There's no doubt about it. Every sport, the Atlanta Braves want to be world champion. The Dallas Cowboys want to be world champions. The American males are world champions. And I tell you right now, we're going to show it in the ring. We'll do the best we can. And I guarantee you right now, the American males will come out on top.
You know what I want to do? I want to spend a little time on the road with you two guys.
Hey.
I have seen you do very well for yourselves. I thank you very much. Scott Riggs, Marcus Alexander Bagwell, the American males, they will be part of World War III on pay-per-view November 26th.
Wrestling, Dusty. It's Mr. Wonderful against this huge, this monster, Dave Sullivan.
He knew from the get-go, Christopher. He knew I gotta get this guy down. I gotta get him a position where he can't get up and hurt me. I gotta send a message right away because I am Mr. Wonderful. I am gorgeous. I do believe in myself. I believe in being the best that I can be. And right here, he is just choking the dog right out of Dave right there.
And Mr. Wonderful, a veteran of more than 20 years of these ring wars, and he is not backing down from anybody. What muscularity, but 295 pounds of power by Dave Sullivan, accompanied by Ralph the Rabbit. And look at this, a bear hug. It could be all over. Waldorf's career could end here.
What a fitting end. What a quick end this could be right here. He got a thumb in the eye, and his emotions have to run towards the deep end right now. Yes.
There's such tension here about this match. Oh, look at this. Suplex. And the crowd gets behind Dave Sullivan. Man, Orndorff's back could be permanently injured by that suplex and by that bear hug. And look at those lefts and rights from Dave Sullivan. Oh, man! What back and forth on this match.
You've seen the power, though, where it didn't take him off his feet in there. A high suplex on the back of his neck. Surely that took it out of Dave.
That could be it for Dave Sullivan. Back and forth. What a seesaw match this has been. Exclusively here on the Prime. And Orndorff now, as we said, the 20-year veteran. This is a man who's taken Hulk Hogan to the very limits. He's taken Dusty Rhodes to the very limits. And now it looks like he's going to do the same to Dave Sullivan.
So much confidence in Paul, Mr. Wonderful Orndorff, since he's seen the man that goes in and tells you, you are beautiful, you are wonderful, you are the greatest athlete in WCW. Turn this career around. And Dave Sullivan is taking the brunt of this attack as he wiggles and jiggles and falls on his, what do you call that?
Esophagus.
Yes, yes.
Will Dave Sullivan ever swallow again?
Will he ever swallow again?
He may need medical attention. Is his tongue still... Yes.
He's coughing up crimson.
Oh. He's reaching for help. This is so tough to watch, Dusty. As Dave Sullivan is almost brutally violated by Orndorff.
Chris, he had so much on this thing. He anticipated this match so much. And to get caught really from the get-go, to get in a situation where you get down by 24 to nothing right off the bat in the first quarter. I mean, it's got to be heart-wrenching.
Well, it
for
is.
The Dave, let me finish. For the Dave Sullivan fans, okay.
For the millions of Dave Sullivan fans, let me correct you.
Oh, he hit him low. Come on, ref. Stop this. He hit him low. Wow, devastating shot. Mr. Wonderful now really, I mean, dominating this match, Christopher.
We are, I'll tell you, everybody on the edge of their seats just wondering what Orndorff will do with Sullivan. Hey, is that a chokehold? This is too important a match for Orndorff to be allowed to choke Dave Sullivan.
We said from the get-go in our analysis of this thing, how will he overcome the body weight, the stature, the size of Dave, and the heart of Dave? But truly, he has done that this whole match long.
And as we said earlier also, what a heartbreaker this would be for Dave Sullivan. This is winning one for the Gipper. And the Gipper in this
the
case...
Ralpher.
The Ralpher and the Gipper. The Gipper in this case being his sister, who is just recovering now from a very serious illness. She needs all the encouragement she can get. And what a dramatic encouragement it would be if Dave Sullivan defeated Orndorff.
Yes, he heard us. He's feeling it. Nice. Yes. Whoa!
And Sullivan came back. He's back with a vengeance. And Orndorff, he looks like he's ready to be defeated. Look out! A lariat by Sullivan. The lefts, they don't stop. Orndorff is powerless. He's helpless against this brutal onslaught of Dave Sullivan, who says, oh no!
Could it be?
It can't end this way.
Could it be?
Will he get him up?
Will he get him up?
Oh, no. Sullivan is up. And a pile driver. Oh, Dusty. Will his sister ever recover?
Will he ever recover? Devastating, devastating loss. The pile driver never applied more beautifully, if you will, by Mr. Wonderful. Now, as he addresses himself in the mirror, and he looks at what he thinks is the most beautiful face in the world, the WCW's finest athlete, Mr. Wonderful, once again on his new career, if you will, revitalized Mr. Wonderful over Dave Sullivan.
Fans are crying. I see tears out there.
Well, right here, such a great goal. But man, right in the chops, it rocked him. But reaching down for everything he had, but too late, too little too late. As you see the belly draped in the arms, you see the pile driver, and you see Mr. Wonderful now crawl on top of the dejected, inflated, if you will, Dave Sullivan.
I'm not sure that Sullivan will ever recover
And fans, I'm going to have to take a quick break myself.
Hey,
see if we can get
back. I think Boone is here.
We're back in 2 minutes, maybe.
Well, Dusty, now was supposed to be the time where we were going to see Johnny Boone. But instead, according to your information, you've kind of traveled all around the dressing rooms, and you have determined... Don't imitate me! I don't imitate you!
I didn't, okay.
And you have determined that Johnny Boone is essentially a no-show. We're not going to see the man today.
Well, I'm not so sure. I'm getting ready for the Moon Match of the Week. It's the prime cut match. I went on record last week, Christopher Cruz, in the world around the globe. On Prime, that must air 1 million times a day.
Yep.
And I said Johnny Boone gonna make a name for himself next week against the Starcaster.
Star Blazer.
Against the Star Blazer.
We're broadcasters.
Sex Pistols. I don't know who they are. But I know one thing, that a big man named Big Train Bart is sitting in extra locker room right now in Johnny Boone's chair. So Bart disappointed me. And boom, when this is over, I'm going to come looking for you.
Where is this thing going?
And I'm going to whip your butt in public. Nobody crack whip with a dream on television.
All right, here we are, ready for action involving the Star Blazer and Dusty. As we said, Johnny Boone, a no-show. He was supposed to be in this prime match this week.
You see the Star Blazer, and I passed by his locker room and seen him getting ready, and,
Did you see him without his mask?
No. But I know one thing. I've seen the Big Train Bart. I'm talking 300 pounds or better, maybe 340, 350. You know what I'm talking about? So much power. And the Star Blazer here is surely going to be outweighed in this situation.
All right, we are awaiting the entrance of Big Train Bart, who we've seen before, and we know just how big he is. Star Blazer looks to be about 240, 230 maybe, so he's giving away about 70 pounds to this massive man.
Well, right here, Star Blazer, new on the scene, and Big Train Bart really trying to make a name when you go about, when you get in a prime cut match of the week, when you're in the prime matchup right here on Prime, that means the main event right here, and try to get a victory here is so important for both these guys.
Whoa, got the Big Train down. Choo-choo. A nice arm drag there by the Star Blazer. So what you're saying is you know absolutely nothing about this guy.
Research, talking to people saying they had seen him in Japan and over New York, and he was quick and fast. And how quick and fast are you going to be with this big guy clubbing on you?
Oh, look at that. Big Train Bart tried to hang on but couldn't. And Bart said, whoa, wait just a minute here. I think he realizes he's got some real competition. Now the collar and elbow tie-up. And Star Blazer, oh, a full-arm dragon twist, and does it the opposite way. And Bart does not look like he knows how to counter a wrestling move, Dusty.
Well, sure he does. He just got to outpower him. That's what he has to do. He has to reach down and outpower him. He has to get a victory here on the Prime Match of the Week right here on WCW Prime. What a show we've had here. World War III right around the corner. We're talking about big pay-per-view. Three rings, 60 men in the battle royal, winner to meet Hulk Hogan for the World Heavyweight title. And right here, more importantly, this is World War III for Bart and Star Blazer. This is the opportunity to get a win on national television.
Yeah, in fact, we talk a lot about upcoming pay-per-views, Dusty, but when we're doing that, when there's a match in the ring, it is important to point out, as you just did, that for them, for those wrestlers, there is no more important match than that one occurring at that very moment.
Well, who's to say that maybe there's two slots left in that 60-man battle royal? Who's to say that the winner of this thing might get in that thing in World War III on pay-per-view and get an opportunity to get all that money, get all that fame, and get all that fortune? So it is important to these guys, both of them. Star Blazer, I thought, would have more speed, you know, looking at his stature. But maybe you can't use your speed with a man this big.
Three rings, three giants, and the winner of the three-ring 60-man battle royal to get a shot at the WCW World Heavyweight Championship, which I thought was held by Hulk Hogan, although physically the belt is held by the giant.
Well, make no mistake about it, Hulk Hogan is the World Heavyweight Champion. But the belt is with the giant, and the giant say possession is 9/10 of the law. I got the belt. If you want to come and get it, I guarantee you, Hulkamania will be after that thing because it is his, belongs to him, and the thief, if you will, the taskmaster, the giant, and the low-down, dirty, rotten dog, Jimmy Hart, will pay at the hands of Hulk Hogan.
And a
whole lot more coming up here that we'll be telling you about, in fact, on WCW Prime. Of course, you already heard that in a return match, it's going to be Lex Luger against Macho Man Randy Savage. And then the women's tag team challenge match. That's going to be a challenge for us to pronounce. I'll try.
What? Well, I tell you, you know, we get nude from the front.
Who has come in?
We get the front, and people are all around so excited about this Big Train Bart matchup. And, you know, this is something that you could actually say is so important that everybody's watching it.
Now, let's try it again. It's Bull Nakano and Akira Hokuto.
Yeah, Akira Hokuto.
And Mayumi Ozaki and Cutie Suzuki.
Yeah, well, your mama, too. Anyway, nice move right there by the Big Train. And here he comes, the Starblazer, now on fire.
You know, the reason I was distracted for a moment, I thought I saw Bobby the Brain Heenan here in the arena. But
oh, you know he wouldn't be close to me.
It was
But he's been in serious business with the we've seen deals of him with the Japanese people taking money and stuff.
Yeah.
So there's always something up his sleeve.
He's selling
always
something he doesn't own. That's what I'm told he's trying to do.
Starblazer
now up. Oh, look out! He's got Big Train Bart. He's going to pin this man. He does. 1, 2, 3.
To me, is an upset.
The Starblazer, the relatively unknown Starblazer, comes on here on the prime cut match of the week and pins the more than 300-pound Big Train Bart. And Dusty, take it away for our prime replay of the week.
Well, right here, Starblazer come off top and just straddled him, took the weight down and hooked them big old legs back there. Got a couple thighs and a couple calves and hooked him up. 1, 2, 3.
And when we come back, a word about next week involving Lex Luger and Sting. So don't go away.
Let's get ready to rumble!
You can't beat these cards.
WCW Main Event trading cards are available at Speedway and Starvin' Marvin.
Is this for me?
Let's give that back to Santa.
Not so fast.
New Long John Silver's country-style popcorn shrimp with fries, just $1.99.
Okay, kid.
One more thing. On Dasher, on
just
All right, that does it for this week's edition of WCW Prime. But Dusty, I'll tell you, I just got the word from the producer about what's happening next week. The Blue Bloods to take on Lex Luger and Sting. Now, Lex Luger is now a member of the Dungeon of Doom as of Halloween Havoc. Sting got the stuffing beaten out of him by Ric Flair, Arn Anderson, and Flying Brian Pillman. Why are they going to team up?
That is two statements that you made are not progressive with the truth.
Or mutually exclusive.
Yeah, right. Now, Dungeon of Doom, we think Luger has dealings with them.
Right.
Luger comes out with Jimmy Hart, who really isn't a member of the Dungeon of Doom, and he takes Sting, his longtime partner. In the words of a very famous producer in Hollywood, Woodrow, said that you can never trust your friends if you can't trust your closest friend. Who can you trust? And they're supposed to wrestle next week on the Prime. I got to talk to somebody.
I'm confused. We'll see you next week on the Prime.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
People often ask, what I like to snap best? Arms? Legs? Oh, I like a beefy, spicy Slim Jim. Step into it, yeah!
Next Generation Gaming and Mega Movie based action collide in Street Fighter, the movie. Digitized characters from the film plus all new super attacks and combo finish moves make this the best Street Fighter yet from Acclaim.
Hey, Remington. Shave this.
The Remington Triple Foil. The only shaver with three micro screens now has a 50% greater cutting rate. If you can grow it, we can shave it.
Arcade graphics, arcade secrets, pulse-pounding music and sound effects. Nothing, nothing can prepare you for more. Let the combat continue from Acclaim.
It's WCW Prime Wrestling. Hi, everyone. I'm Chris Cruz, along with the American Dream.
I got news.
Dusty Rhodes, you got news.
Go ahead. Read down the show. I got news. You don't even know.
All right. We're going to go back with Hacksaw Jim Duggan as he traces his roots in Ireland. And we're going to see if we can focus Dusty on what's going on. He's still gathering some news. We'll also see Scott Norton. And that intriguing main event, our Prime Match of the Week, involving the Blue Bloods against Lex Luger and Sting. Why are those two guys teaming up? So what's your news?
The news is this. walking into the building right before the prime was getting ready to explode worldwide. I see two dressing rooms. One was Luger. One was Steam. They used to dress together. I mean, when they wrestle, right. They dress together.
Right.
They used to dress together, and now they are apart. I can't wait for this matchup today.
All right, now let's take you to the ring as we kick off the prime. Dusty, it's all right to say that we're about to see possibly one of the toughest men to ever enter professional wrestling. And that is saying a lot because they don't come any tougher as a sport than wrestling, and they may not come any tougher, or at least tougher looking, than Scott Norton. But we know one thing, he is sure big and strong and powerful. Wondering, too, about that big World War III pay-per-view coming up. Three rings, 60 men in a battle royal. Will Scott Norton be one of them men? Time will tell, my friend. And of course, now we know that it's going to be, well, actually, we at this point know that it's going to be Lex Luger against Macho Man Randy Savage. We are receiving word. There's some rumors about some other matches, and Mean Gene Okerlund standing by in the World War III Control Center, and he'll tell us what he's got so far this week, and Chuck Williams gets chopped by Scott Norton.
Just thrown across the ring, and then laid to rest right there. Scott Norton, so big and so powerful right here on WCW Prime. And he wants somebody hurt. You heard that? And hurt bad.
He in the past has gone after Shark. As tough and big as Scott Norton is. And a Shark's over 500 pounds, Dusty. What do you think is getting into the head of Scott Norton that would make him want to go after Shark?
Well, he knows this is where the big boys play. And if you're going to be where the big boys play, you got to take on the big boys.
And we're also going to see this hour on the Prime. Buckhouse Buck and Dirty Dick Slater, the former World Tag Team Champions, taking on Eddie Guerrero and the Cobra. That is a unique team. Kurosawa is going to be here. And then the Blue Bloods against... I don't even know what to say about this team of Sting and Lex Luger. Dusty, you're going to have to explain what's going on.
No, we talked about it. So understanding the situation of friendship with Luger and Sting, you know, the only thing I say to Sting is what I said before the Flash situation. Don't trust Lex Luger. Maybe between them two right there, they still got a thing going. We're going to find out right here on the Prime today.
Well, let's go. Oh, man, Scott Norton with a right. What is this? He picks him up.
Got him in a backbreaker up there, and then he just lays him into a shoulder breaker. This is it.
Or Chuck Williams never had a chance. An excellent wrestler, but against Scott Norton, I don't think it's going to work.
Well, it didn't work. We've seen that right there. Scott Norton probably looking for
to get you, boy.
Still
looking for the shot.
Well, a place to do it is in World War III, only on pay-per-view with 3 weeks and 60 men in the big battle royal.
Scott Norton, awesome individual.
We take a look right here of just pure power. Pure power. I mean, that's nothing, no finesse. It is pure power. Picks him up right here, gets him in a backbreaker, and to add insult to injury, nearly breaks the kid's shoulder right here. He drops him down there, gets the 1-2-3. The man Scott Norton, big, bad, and powerful.
Our prime match of the week, it's the Blue Bloods, Regal Eaton, against Sting and Lex Luger. And when we come back, Buckhouse Buck and Dirty Dick Slater, the former World Tag Team Champs, take on Eddie Guerrero and Cobra.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following main event contest is set for one fall. Introducing first, accompanied to the ring by Colonel Robert Parker from Bucksport, Tennessee, Funkhouse Buck. His tag team partner from Port Tampa, Florida, Dirty Dick Slater.
I am sitting here afraid, Dusty, because as ornery as they were when they were World Tag Team Champions, having lost it, they are even more so. See, there's Buckhouse Buck and Dick Slater as well, almost hitting our cameraman. Now, what is that all about? What right do they have to touch the cameraman?
Well, they always on the prowl.
You're going to give a couple of pounds, little trip to Buckstone.
Yes, a little trip to Buckstone, but, you know, these two guys are great athletes. They won the World Tag Team title once again. And I guarantee you, they're as mean as they come, as you said. And even be in the same building with them sometimes could be a little rambunctious, if you will.
what a match this is going to be. Tag team action here on WCW Prime. A fairly new tag team here in World Championship Wrestling about to be introduced as we take you to Dave Pencer.
Their opponents first from El Paso, Texas, Eddie Guerrero. His tag team partner from Langley, Virginia, Oprah.
Well, Dusty, I know that you're going to be rooting for your fellow Texan, Eddie Guerrero.
Well, I tell you, you know, mixed emotions. Buck, I don't like. Colonel Parker, Dick Slater. We have been world tag team champions together. We have been singly fighting each other for years, but we have been very, very close friends on numerous occasions. Still call him my friend. But bottom line, Eddie Guerrero from Texas, known his father, known his brothers, do have mixed emotions. Guerrero and Slater obviously would be the matchup I would want to see one-on-one. In a tag situation, I believe Eddie Guerrero will take a back seat here because an unproven partner, if you will, great athlete, I hear, but the man they call Cobra. And I use the word great by, from what I said, I hear. You got to prove it to me right here. This be a prime place to prove it on Prime.
Cobra nearly 270 pounds, and Eddie Guerrero not to be intimidated.
Here's a matchup I wanted right here.
It is indeed. You called it Eddie Guerrero to face off against Dirty Dick Slater, reputed to have one of the hardest heads and to be simply just one of the toughest men, so almost immune to pain. And it's not funny. And look at that. He just drops the shoulder and down goes Guerrero. Interesting size difference between the two of them. Leapfrog there by Guerrero. Beautiful drop kick. You know, you mentioned his brothers and his father. I find it very interesting that there is such an age discrepancy, disparity between the brothers and Eddie Guerrero. Eddie Guerrero is younger than the brothers by about 8 or 10 years. So he has really literally grown up seeing his older brothers wrestle as well as his father wrestle.
Well, when you are in a situation the way you have been around it all your life, then, you know, if you have that ability, it just comes out. And right here, this is a good matchup right here now, I'm telling you. But Eddie Guerrero just too quick. Nice move.
Guerrero able to combine mat wrestling and high-flying aerial maneuvers with acrobatics in a way that some say is absolutely unmatched. That pound for pound, as you have pointed out, Dusty, he may be the best wrestler in North America, possibly the best wrestler in the world. And we've got him right here in World Championship Wrestling and right here on Prime. And he is very frustrating at this point to Dick Slater.
You know, sometimes you go back and you say, well, Jack Briscoe, you know, they said pound for pound. He was the world's heavyweight wrestling champion. Dory Funk Jr. was the world's heavyweight wrestling champion. I mean, it's hard to say that a guy pound for pound is the best. Dean Malenko comes to mind to me right now. And it's hard with him. That's why I don't really put him so much in that category as he could be. But, you know, only time will tell. Right now, they're looking good, though. All offense for Guerrero.
Watch this.
Cobra. And that's not a frog jump there, is it?
No, that's not a frog jump. Well, I wondered if Guerrero, realizing that he's getting an experienced partner, wasn't going to tag him until later. Now Cobra easily picks up Bunkhouse Buck, who's about 6'6", and drops the elbow. Ooh, right on the top of the head. And goes for the pin. He hooks the leg, gets one and a half.
Eddie never goes out there without a game plan. And Dick Slater's the same. And the game plan laid out by Colonel Parker. But, you know, right here, they're using speed and now they're using power. So one complementing the other.
Dick Slater, again, as we said, one half, formerly one half of the World Tag Team Champions, is whipped in by the Cobra, and the Cobra a little bit slow in the uptake, and Dusty, look what he gets for making that mistake. He gets a shot there from Dirty Dick Slater, who will take every opportunity.
Well, now he finally got a tag in here and get old Bunkhouse Buck in there. A little double teaming going up, and momentum seems to have been turned around here. Right here on Prime. Every match is the main event on Prime. I guarantee you that much.
You know, also this hour, we're going to travel back to Ireland with Hacksaw Jim Duggan as he takes a look at his roots. And we're being told that we're going to have to take a very quick break. About 2 minutes long, yes, about 2 minutes long, maybe shorter. And when we come back, we'll have the continuation of this match. Bunkhouse Buck, Dirty Dick Slater against Eddie Guerrero and the Cobra. In a moment. To action here on the Prime, and look at Cobra and Dirty Dick Slater. It looks like Cobra is going to get the better of it, Dusty. Unfortunately, Slater knows how to tie up his opponent. Oh, look at that.
Well, we were away. You know, Colonel Parker laid out a game plan, as I said, for this, and it's not following the game plan of Eddie Guerrero, because Bunkhouse Buck and Dick Slater have kept Cobra over there, and they sat at the ballpark. Oh, this might be it right here.
Christopher Cruz, but Slater taking exception there with Eddie Guerrero.
I'm not sure why Slater did that. He may have been able to pin him, as you pointed out, Dusty, and instead he wanted to mess around with Eddie Guerrero.
Yeah, and the referee had to turn his back to get that thing cleaned up. And bad deed done by Bunkhouse Buck.
And a headbutt there. We mentioned before the break that he is reputed to have the hardest head in wrestling, and he's using that to good effect. One, two, and no, Cobra will not be pinned. At 270 pounds, he's got enough power to kick out and do that with authority, and he just did that. But Cobra clearly needs to tag into Eddie Guerrero, but Dusty, Eddie Guerrero is not the power man on this team, so what's Guerrero going to have to do?
Well, he's the brains. He's got, like I say, he's got the game plan. Obviously, he went over it, but they got in a situation now to where it slips away from him, and when you see it slip away from him, it's like a football game. When the game starts slipping away from you, it's hard to get back and make a big comeback on that situation, especially with Slater taking shots at him, getting the referee's attention. Nice move down the part of Dick Slater, and you see them just clubbing. That's clubbing going on in the prime.
There it
is. Four fists on one guy. We've seen it. Clubbing. Slater told me, he said, we're going to clubber for you and Christopher Cruz.
That's something that we sometimes feel like doing to Diana. She makes us work too hard. She makes us do things over. Don't you agree?
I'm not even stepping in that. You know what I mean? Because you already stepped in it, and sometimes you come out be smelly. Bottom line, Diane, great producer here. Prime is the most watched program on stations like Sports South and Home Sports Network down in Texas and all across New York and everything. So, you know, she has gained in stature by having me here. You are a guest.
She's a genius, I think.
Oh, look at that double stomp. I made you laugh. I got you. Nobody can imitate Dusty Rhodes better than me. Ready? Ready? I'll do some.
Okay,
more.
Do this one. Do it. Do it like me.
It's a Rhodeism. Boy, I didn't get to say
no,
that first for
no.
It's clubbering.
No, that was a drop kick.
Oh, see that? Guy with a duck, yeah. With a duck kick, and panic if you will.
And he won that. Good. You did good.
Okay.
You want to do more?
No,
do,
no, it's okay.
Okay.
He won that tag. He got it. Come on, Eddie. Fire him, Eddie.
Goodness. And Guerrero. Indeed, he is firing on the former World Tag Team champs. Taking them both on. The lean and lanky Bunkhouse Buck goes up and over. Cobra. He looks to have taken a pretty severe beating. Hey, what is that all about?
Slater about to tag him with the boot right there. You see it fall in the middle of the ring. Now it's all broken loose. There's a big four-way going on here. That boot is laying there at rest.
Oh, and Guerrero went, wow. He went way over those ropes.
Well, they ripping at the eyes. Now the referee trying to get Bunkhouse Buck out of here. Slater minus the boot. Got them BBD socks on.
And he drops down. Shades of Mr. Wonderful. He's got that pile driver.
Nobody does a pile driver like Mr. Wonderful.
Nope.
Nobody.
You're exactly right. And what is Slater?
Slater looking for his shoes, man. Need to get his boot covered. What happened here?
The colonel says get on him and cover it. Well, I think the referee indicating that it's Bunkhouse Buck who is the legal man, frankly.
Hey!
I lost control. I lost track. Look at the face on Guerrero. Flying cross body block. One, two, three. He's got it.
Fabulous.
Control center. Also, when we come back, as Dusty says, Kunasawa in the pulpit. Here on WCW Prime, Chris Cruz and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And Dusty, interesting look at the roots of Heyo, Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
Well, I tell you what, a long line of tape fist fighters he come from, and I guarantee he might get new life coming back from there, finding out where his roots are.
The Kurosawa Crush, a specialty of a man who needs, I think, no tape at all to be as devastating as he is.
Well, Colonel Parker, he's having a lot of airtime on the prime right here because now he brings out another mean and bad man in Kurosawa. Break an arm there against Joey Mag.
And now that we have the Lector of Love with us, I think it's time for an update on the situation between Sister Sherry and Colonel Parker.
Well, it's on again and off again every once in a while.
I have heard that wedding bells may be ringing in the future.
Well, I would. That's one wedding that I would go to Bucksnort to attend, I guarantee you. I would like to see that. That'd be some mud pie going on down there. Hog slopping.
I could just sit here and you go on and on and on about it.
I was looking to kill Sauer here, man. I tell you what a massive athlete this guy is. And Jumping Joey Mag. You know, you see on the back of his trunk where it says jumping?
Yeah.
Well, he say to me, I said, Joey, I say, it says jumping on the back of your trunk. He say, when I win another match, then I can put the Joey on there, and I win another one, put Mags on there. So right now he's in the jumping part. He got jumping on there.
Again,
and luckily
fans.
He got a big enough butt that he can get all that on there.
You would you mean? Please? Oh. Come on now, gain control. Fence, for those of you who have just tuned in, Dusty Rhodes made that all up. You know you did. Now come clean with us, Dusty. You're not going to lawyer. 222 pounds of jumping Joey Max. Amanda Teddy Long has been taking a look at
yes,
Teddy.
Yes, he has.
The former WCW Manager of the Year. What are you here? Does he want to get back into managing?
You know, I don't know about that situation right there, but I know that he thinks a whole lot of Joey Max, as WCW does. But in situations like this, Joey's just got to keep from getting himself injured real badly.
Mags is a great kid, but his loss record, as you pointed out, is not all that good. And here comes, there's Teddy Long in the background as we see Colonel Parker laying in the boots to a wide-open jumping Joey Mags.
Well, we did see Teddy Long. You mentioned that situation. I knew he was here in the building, and... you know, Kel Sauer don't care if it's Teddy Long or Huey Long. It don't make him any difference. He's got him right by the jumping. As I said earlier, fans, there will be more letters on that trunk as time goes on in Joey's career. Letters are like 35 cents a piece. And then you got to pay somebody to sew them on.
Is there anybody out there who can help me stop this man?
My ex-partner Murdoch, my great friend and great partner, he used to, you could read a book on his hind end.
Oh, no, here comes a Japanese submission armbar, and this is no laughing matter.
Well, he don't want to break it. I mean, this is what breaks arms right here. Joey Mags give up.
This, indeed, is the move that broke Hawk's arm, and
Teddy can't believe this.
Is he sad or disgusted or...
No, I think he sees something in the kid that is not coming out. You know what? I really believe that. I know Teddy Long, and I know that.
And Kurosawa proceeds to meditate.
Oh. Teddy is up at the ringside now. See, I'll take care of this business.
Indeed he is. No hair and a couple of earrings there and some gold jewelry befitting a man of his stature and success in the community in Atlanta.
All right, you see that? Take it easy. Come on. I'll tell you what, some guidance there by Teddy Long. You see, Corsair, he'll just manhandle and enjoy jumping. I'm just going to call him jumping now. And you see, jumping outside, get a kick from Colonel Parker, like I say, getting so much airtime. And right here, luckily, he didn't come out there with a broken arm because he wrapped it up and took him home.
When we come back, Mean Gene Okerlund in the World War III Control Center. Three giants, three rings, a 60-man battle royal. Will he confirm rumors involving Ric Flair and Sting at World War III? We're back with that in a moment.
Okerlund here in the control center just 1 week from this Sunday. We're in Norfolk, Virginia for World War III. Call your cable company now and join us live for what's turning out to be one of the most important events in world championship wrestling history. As you know, the championship committee has held up the WCW World Heavyweight title after the controversy at Halloween Havoc. The official ruling now states the winner of the three-ring, 60-man, over-the-top rope battle royal will be crowned the new WCW World Heavyweight Champion. By the way, the two men at the center of that controversy in Detroit, Hulk Hogan and the 7'3" 400-pound giant. Both lay claim to the title, and both will be in that exciting battle royal. They're going to be joined by another 58 of the greatest international stars from literally all over the world. Listen, they're going to be coming from Mexico, Great Britain, Japan, Germany, Canada, Tonga, India, and of course the good old U.S. of A. Sting, Lex Luger, the Macho Man, Randy Savage, Shark, Disco Inferno, Big Bubba, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, BK Wall Street, Arn Anderson, Ric Flair, Sergeant Craig Pittman, Mr. Wonderful, Johnny B. Bad, Harlem Heat, Bunkhouse Buck and Dirty Dick Slater, Kurosawa, Eddie Guerrero, Diamond Dallas Page, Cobra, The Nasty Boys, American Males, Ming, Flying Brian, The Blue Bloods, Chris Benoit, plus added this week, Renegade, Road Warrior Hawk, Alex Wright, JL, and Sabu. Keep in mind, in this battle royal, each ring will have a giant. The giant we know is the son of Andre. In another ring, the Yeti. And in a third ring, a giant of a man, both in physical stature and accomplishment, the most popular man in the history of the game, former WCW heavyweight champion Hulk Hogan. Lex Luger and Randy Savage meet in a return from Halloween Havoc. The Macho Man injured recently on Monday Nitro, climbing Savage, certainly not 100%. Four of the greatest women wrestlers from Japan, Bull Nakano and Akira Hakuto, meet Cutie Suzuki and Mayumi Ozaki. Ric Flair and Sting straight ahead. Big Bubba to meet Hacksaw Jim Duggan in a taped fist match. World Television Champion Johnny B. Badd defends against Diamond Dallas Page, and the new U.S. champ, Kensuke Sasaki, will defend the belt that he won earlier this week against Chris Benoit. One way or another, join us live for World War III. Just a week from this Sunday at 7 o'clock Eastern Time, 4 out of the West Coast, available only on pay-per-view, home satellite through Turner Premier, and on DirecTV. World War III, Sunday, November 26th. Order now. Right around the corner, World War III, Sunday, November the 26th, available exclusively on pay-per-view. Call your cable company right now, and please keep your mitts to yourself. Joining me, the Harlem Heat, current reigning WCW Tag Team Champions, Booker T, Stevie Ray, along with manager Sister Sherry. You know, you got 60 of the finest in three rings, including a giant in each one of those rings. Winner gets a shot at the World Heavyweight Champion.
And we don't care who's going to be in the ring, because me and my brother, we coming into this thing fully focused, a self-contained unit, if you understand what I'm talking about. Me and my brother, we are the World Tag Team Champions, and we got those belts by ourselves, if you know what I'm talking about, because somebody ain't been in pocket lately, if you know what I'm saying. This time, me and my brother, we going in the World Tag Team Champions, but one of us is going to come out the World Heavyweight Champion, if you know what I'm saying.
Stevie Ray.
You know, Gene, not since the D-Day invasion will you see this kind of fury unleashed on 58 of the sucker.
That's right.
If you know what I'm talking about.
I got an idea.
Well, 58 guys and two brothers. You know what that equals?
60.
A whole lot of chumps getting beat up. As far as we talking about. Three wings, 60 guys. Two brothers.
That's right.
Somebody gonna get hurt, and you're gonna be on the critical list.
All right, Sister Sherry, they're not gonna be operating as a team. It's gonna be 60 men, and of course, all fighting for the same thing.
Yes, they're all going to be fighting for the same thing. And unlike some people think, Sister Sherry is going to go into that three-ring circus, and we are going to be focused. It is going to be Booker T, Stevie Ray, and Sherry,
thank you very much. They're going to be part of World War III on Sunday, November the 26th, on pay-per-view.
I'll have you know that there is no hair left on my hand.
Well, can you imagine when Hacksaw Jim Duggan take one of them big paws of his and lay that right hook and hook that left in there? Just like his grandma taught him, he went back and he found out what it was all about. But let me tell you something. I mean, all kidding aside, when we talk about prime wrestling, that's where we see the best. Me and this man, he up here, bring it to your broadcast journalism. You know what I'm talking about? And tell you about potatoes and all these things. But bottom line here, serious incident going on. Sting, Luger, friend for life. One man, I believe, has befriended the other one. So I am anxious to see this a Sith move match of the week. So I'm going to give you a Sith move on the prime Sith move match of the week. Sith move.
Real serious.
Okay.
Very serious.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following contest, your main event of the evening, is set for one fall. Introducing first, from Blackpool, England, weighing 18 stones, 2 pounds, Lord Stephen Rico. His tag team partner from Stoke-on-Trent, England, weighing 17 stones, 1 pound, Earl Robert Eaton. They are the Blue Bloods.
Well, thank you for coming back just in time, Dusty, taking a quick break. And the Blue Bums.
Now, I was really concerned with that situation with Sting and Luger. Now, I got my scouts out there, and they're out there looking around right now, and I guarantee you there seems to be a situation here to where everything else is went awry. Everything else is went crazy, but it seems that Sting and Luger are still together.
Your opponent's first from Chicago, 267 pounds, the total package, Lex Luger. His partner from Venice Beach, California. Heavyweight champion, this is
and you know what else this is? This is just plain weird, Dusty. Lex Luger, ostensibly a member of the Dungeon of Doom after attacking Randy Savage at the behest of the Taskmaster Kevin Sullivan in Halloween Havoc. Sting, of course, attacked by Ric Flair, who he'll be facing at World War III, we just heard, and attacked by Arn Anderson and Brian Pillman. What in the heck is Sting doing teaming up with Lex Luger? Please tell me.
Well,
Please explain.
It goes back a long time, as I said, and they both have an agreement with each other, I guess, and a friendship there. Sting knowing that not trusting Ric Flair was something that he shouldn't have done, but he wanted to go and get Iron and Pillman, and that was part of the deal. And right here, it looks like the Blue Bloods in this great matchup right here on WCW Prime are seeing Sting and Luger.
Right across the face. What bloody circus did you escape from?
What? Boy, he's on the fans all the time. Bad attitude, I'm talking about Blue Bloods.
What an attitude indeed, but what a tremendous technical wrestler. I think few can compete. Few can compare when it comes to Lord Stephen Regal. He is so delicate and yet can be so brutal. He pushes back the wrist of Sting. Just that little maneuver is so painful. But Sting with a reversal and does it on his own. Look at this.
Well, Sting's got a lot of knowledge, and I've called him on several occasions the franchise player at WCW. And you know, he goes through valleys where he has his peaks and his ups and downs. But right now, I mean, going through his mind, I got to say, Chris, how can he trust Lex Luger?
I mean, are we going to see right here on Prime today, Dusty, what happened to Sting at Halloween Havoc at the hands of the Nature Boy Ric Flair also happened at the hands of Lex Luger? Lex Luger, a member of the Dungeon of Doom. This is, you got to really call
it
a question.
You know, we say that's true, but as far as Sting and Luger go, obviously they proved that they want to come out and win this tag match, and really that's what it's all about.
Yeah, ultimately, if you can set aside your personal differences and you're able to defeat the Blue Bloods, that may be good enough.
For instance, 60 men in the Battle Royal. Yeah, you got friends in there. You got foes in there. The object is, the trophy at the end is who will meet the World Heavyweight Champion. Hulk Hogan, even though he doesn't have the belt and the Giant's running around with it, he is the World Heavyweight Champion. So who will meet him? That's the ultimate thing. No friends. So like you said, in a tag match situation, they probably had this thing booked with WCW. You know what I mean? The great people that are matchmakers that put this thing together had it long before the feathers hit the fan.
And Sting and Lex Luger, having signed a contract, have just decided to go ahead with it. That is formerly Beautiful Bobby Eaton, now known as Earl Robert Eaton, or Robert the Earl of Eaton, whatever you want to say.
Duke.
The Duke. Oh, no. Don't get me started on that one. He used to be the master of Alabama, the Alabama Jam. It's now called the Tower of London. This is our main event this week here on WCW Prime, our prime match of the week, as Eaton goes to work on the U.S. Heavyweight Champion. It is Sting and Lex Luger against the Blue Bloods, Robert the Earl of Eaton and Lord Stephen Regal. And the action is just heating up. But we have got to take a very quick break. We'll be back in 2 minutes. Don't go away. Back to action here on the Prime. It's Lord Stephen Regal. Oh, he is reversed there by Lex Luger. High back body drop. It's our Prime match of the week. Lex Luger and Sting against the Blue Bloods. And Regal is horrified, Dusty.
I tell you what, horrified. But, Duke of Earl right here, Earl of Bob, is in there right now. And I guarantee you one thing that has to be done here since we've been away. They got to switch the momentum around a little bit, because Sting and Luger, no matter what we've been talking about, now we've set into the match. We're deep into it, if you will. And they have dominated the Blue Bloods.
Look at the pecs there of Lex Luger. He's flexing the pecs, I think, to intimidate Robert the Earl of Eaton.
That ain't going to intimidate Robert the Earl of Eaton, I guarantee you, because he's been in there before. But that will, an old fist right in the nose. He got him too. Hit somebody else.
What is that on the back of Eaton's head? Now back to action here. Oh, man. Luger ran right into it, and what a slap there by Eaton that levels the total package.
What do you mean, what's on the back of his head?
Some dark spot or something on the back of his head.
Well, they were outside training and walked under a tree, and that was a pigeon. Anyway, right here now, the Blue Bloods might have turned it around a little bit. Here we go.
The Blue Bloods, an excellent team, certainly being considered for shots at the World Tag Team Champs. Look at this. And a snapmare there after lifting a couple of knees on Lex Luger into a reverse chin lock from Mac.
Right across the face, right across the nose. A lot of force applied by that forearm. As the Blue Bloods now take control of this prime match of the week. Right here on WCW Prime.
Lord Stephen Regal began wrestling professionally at the age of 15. 15 years old, he became a professional wrestler. In England, obviously, by lying to the promoter about his age.
You see that right knee is heavily taped. Still got a knee injury. Talked to him a little bit before he went on. We get along pretty good. You know, I can't understand him, and he dang sure can't understand me.
What do you do? Communicate with notes, or you have an interpreter?
No, we didn't talk. We talk, and Bobby interprets for us. Bobby Averill.
Oh, man. He's from Alabama. You can't understand
he
him?
He is not. He has given up all that. He went to England. He learned to be GQ, if you will.
You've got something going.
Watch it. This is it right here, the Leaning Tower Pizza.
No, it's the Tower of London, formerly known as the Alabama Jam. Oh, and Eaton misses big with that elbow.
He missed it. He went up for a high-risk maneuver. He missed it. And Luger, now will he make the tag to Sting?
Oh, man, what tension there is here. This is high drama. Luger definitely needs to make that tag to Sting. He falls back, and he does it.
Here we go.
Chops, and chops on Regal and on Eaton. Oh, man, both of them going down. He hit him right in the back of the head. A poke of the eye slows down the U.S. heavyweight champ. Look at this.
Oh. Mitch, did you hear Duke Bell say, oh? I mean, that was just... That was blatant right there as he picked him up and he caught his hind end right on the top rope, which is cable, and now everybody's going crazy. Katie by the door, double knocked out by the Blue Bloods. Stinger gets a 1-2-3, and all Duke of Earl could say was, oh, and I say, oh, and somehow Luger and Sting got through this match with no difficulty, and that was strange to me. Christopher Cruz still can't believe it. His head bowed in his lap. I mean, we've heard some sound bites, but I tell you, on Prime, the greatest cameraman, greatest audio man, greatest producer, as we heard that sound bite that turned the match, when Bobby Eaton said, very seriously, he said, no! And that turned the match.
What are you talking about? Sound bite?
Yeah, that was a sound bite.
It's our Power Prime replay of the week.
Here you go with a Prime replay of the week. Got a leapfrog right here. Double knockout.
Get him hooked. Victory. And we'll be back in just a moment with a word about next week.
Whoa!
All right, Dusty, that's going to do it for this week's edition of WCW Prime. Next week, our special Thanksgiving show, we'll be talking turkey, you big lovable butterball, you. Just a joke.
Butterball, butterball, you
butterball, butterball, turkey, talking turkey. Mm-hmm.
Thanksgiving show, right?
Right.
The time for giving.
And forgiving.
And forgiving. You're lucky. Oh. I'm going to forgive you if I call my butterball. Since I have been on my drastic weight loss program, the Prime has seen me nearly shrink, especially in my hip pocket where my wallet is. Anyway, next week, it is turkey trotting time. We're going to have special effects. We're going to be at the big Prime matchup. We're going to see moon matches. We're going to see it all. And we might even have a special turkey roasting like chestnuts on an open fire.
It's a mix of holidays there. We'll see you next week, fans.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
You're getting very, very sleepy, Now step out of it! It's Devin Old Baby Spicy Slim Jim, oh yeah!
Next Generation Gaming and Mega Movie Based Action collide in Street Fighter, the movie. Digitized characters from the film plus all new super attacks and combo finish moves make this the best Street Fighter yet from Acclaim.
Drench your body, drench her soul with new Pierre Cardin Insatiable. A passionate new fragrance for men. Insatiable.
Put up or shut up.
For another edition of New Sport Journal.
This is Dusty Brody, a massive dream, and we are celebrating Thanksgiving right here on the Prime, WCW Prime. I'm in a pumpkin patch. You can see turkeys walking around me. They can't see me because I'm camouflaged Turkey Hunter Day. Not only wrestling, but I will teach you today how to call up a turkey to do the Moo Turkey Match of the Week. And you know, my partner ain't out here is a little embarrassed because they celebrate Thanksgiving. We got him dressed up as a maiden, if you will. Come on in here, Christopher Cruz. Come on, Chris. Come on, Chris. Come on here. Come on in here. Here he is. Look at this. Happy Thanksgiving, Christopher Cruz. Take over.
This is so humiliating.
The turkey cannot see me, but I'm camouflaged.
On the Prime this week, we're going to see Eddie Guerrero. We're going to see... We're going to see Chris Benoit and Ric Flair and a whole lot more, and now we take you to action in the ring. This has got to stop.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following contest is set for one fall. Introducing first, from Clearwater Beach, Florida, weighing 242 pounds, Mark Scourge.
I am not going to wear this thing during the matches. Maybe on camera because it's a Thanksgiving edition of the Prime, but this thing is not staying on me during these matches. I just thought I'd tell you that. I'm humiliated.
Well, excuse me. I take you on a big turkey hunt and you wear that outfit there.
And then my fault.
His opponent from Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, the Canadian Crippler, Chris Benoit.
First began wrestling in 1985. That makes him going on 11 years. And interestingly enough, Mark Starr, Dusty, told me that he has been wrestling 11 years. Hasn't had nearly the success that Chris Benoit has. From 85 to 89, Benoit wrestled primarily in Canada.
Well, I ain't going to have no success with this turkey either if you don't start wearing an outfit like that. You've got to be quiet with the turkey when we see the turkey. Speaking of turkey, Chris Benoit is the turkey of the year. Now a four horseman. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Christopher Benoit. And you say the difference between one style and another style, 11 years, both guys or whatever. Maybe
That was, that one was a little bit hungrier than the other one. You know what I'm talking about? Very simple.
Benoit hungry enough to be, I don't know if he insinuated himself into the Four Horsemen, if he was chosen by the other three. Of course, Pillman, Arn Anderson, and the Nature Boy, Ric Flair. And now, leg scissors there by Mark Starr. From 89 up until just about today, Chris Benoit has been wrestling primarily in Japan. This is his chance to shine and to be where the big boys play, as we say here in World Championship Wrestling. Dusty,
right here in WCW Prime, the prime wrestling program from around the world. And I tell you something about Chris Benoit. He, believe me, he was really chosen by the Nature Boy Ric Flair and Arn Anderson. You know what I'm talking about?
One, two,
and he didn't just endure himself to him, as you said. I just say, maybe I walk on be a Four Horseman. They calculated this thing out just like they calculated the move that they made on the man they call Steve.
Certainly, it's been long established history that the Four Horsemen do only what they want to do and when they want to do it. And right now, Mark Starr is doing just about whatever he wants to do with Chris Benoit. This is a great showing for the young man, Mark Starr. To kick off WCW Prime, the German suplex. He hooks one. No, just gets a two count on Benoit.
Gobble. Hey, so what? I'm trying to call this turkey up.
Whoa! What a slam that was! The turkey was coming until that slam.
I'm sitting by the turkey.
Oh, sorry. Oh, man, Benoit. Oh.
I'll tell you what.
He pushes Mark Starr off, and now Benoit gets up Mark Starr and brings him back and drives him in a suplex onto the back of his neck, but that may have hurt Chris Benoit as well.
You know, Christopher, Mark Starr just got in a bad situation there, trying to do something, maybe that mistake that he made might teach him some down
and
the road.
That could
because
do it. One, two.
Well,
no.
I thought it was.
Thought it was, too.
I thought it was over.
A rollout.
The what?
A rollout by Starr, and Benoit looks to be sucking wind there. Oh, a snap suplex. Interestingly enough, the master of the snap suplex, one, two, was Dynamite Kid. And it is not a coincidence that Chris Benoit does a snap suplex like Dynamite Kid because he was trained
what
by
about
the
Joe
Kid.
What about Joe Blanchard? What about him? He and his era, nobody snapped a suplex like that. What about Dory Funk Jr., Dory Funk Sr.? How does Dynamite Kid even compare to the legendary wrestlers that we have here in America right now? How does Chris Benoit compare to the guys I just mentioned? Everybody always talking about, well, this guy's the master of this, master of 1,000 holds. Well, I know one thing that for sure, Eddie Graham knew more holds than any man in the world. The great Malenko knew more holds than any man in the world.
One, two, three.
You know what I mean? Got my dander up here on the Dynamite Kid. Who means absolutely nothing at this point in time to WCW.
Well, I'll tell you, you talk about the great Malenko, you're talking about his son, Dean Malenko. We'll continue this argument and the turkey hunt in a moment here in the Prime.
Gobble.
We're back on WCW Prime. Chris Cruz in the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and Dusty, the eight-year Mexican veteran, one of four wrestling brothers, the youngest. Real separation in age there from the three oldest to him, about 10 years difference. And Eddie Guerrero, I think he's, I don't know what it is, it's the youngest brother, youngest kid, and he wants to make an impact. Is that what's going on here?
I believe that somehow you went way down in your dictionary, you know what I mean, today?
Yeah.
Because every man that comes out, you got just 8 years, 11 years, 12 years, it doesn't matter. And it's the, what he has, okay, Dusty Wolf, how long he been wrestling?
Probably at least 12 years.
Not probably, not, whoa, wait a minute.
What?
Gobble. Hey. Nope.
Would
I'm
you
telling you,
they can
see you in that hat.
Yeah, I don't blame a turkey. I don't blame anybody for running. Oh,
right,
Guerrero
here
rolls up Dusty Wolf.
You know, right here on WCW Prime, we right off the bat, that's why it's the best wrestling show going. Right off the bat, we done see two great athletes, Chris Benoit, Eddie Guerrero, coming back to back on this situation. More wrestling in two matches than you can see anywhere else in the world. Right here on the Prime. Good takedowns. Got it all right here.
And still to come, we're going to see Ric Flair in action and Mr. Wonderful.
Well, I tell you, he's discombobulated since he got his window broke on his mirror. You know what I mean?
His mirror broke.
Yeah.
Either way, it's a pain.
It's a pain, brother.
P-A-N-E-A.
Yeah, and he can't. What?
See, pain, window pain, and
P-A-I. And I know, I'm not the one supposed to do with the stick here. I'm supposed to call the action. And Dusty Wolf picks up Eddie Guerrero. And Guerrero kicks out. And picks it up again. Wolf has gained some weight since we last saw him.
And it's so fluent and smooth. You know, everything he does is no wasted motion. Kids out there, even in the amateur wrestling ranks, and when they're starting out there in football, baseball, whatever they're playing, little guys, they need to understand there needs to be no wasted motion before you commit. You have to be, throw the first punch, but know what you're doing. Have some type of game plan.
He's been called devilishly versatile. Ooh. In that, Eddie Guerrero.
You know, he's talking about me.
No, well.
I thought he was talking about devilish. Diane called me devilish, but she doesn't use that same D word, but it's close. It's the same furnace. She's talking about.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes she say, "Why don't you go down there?" But anyway, I know I ragtag her. But when she wins an ace, you know what I mean? Now Emmett, because of me, that'd be a different story. And we ain't inviting you with that outfit on you got on today.
I wouldn't show up, believe me.
I would too.
Well,
if Diane was getting an ace of what, and Dusty Rhodes producer, they have to put that up at first. You know what's the matter?
Nothing. I was just watching. Oh man,
there he goes. See, Dusty Rhodes been around, like you said, quite a few years, right?
Yes, quite a few years.
But, you know, everybody, I don't care if you've been around 30 minutes, you got to go in with some type of game plan. And right here, Eddie Guerrero has seen that Wolf wants to make a statement right here on Prime. Right around.
Guerrero, you're right.
Yes or no?
Yes or no?
Yay.
Yes. Yay. Yay. What is this, a courtroom? Oh, two count there by Dusty Wolf on Eddie Guerrero. Guerrero recently, on WCW's Monday Nitro on TNT, had a slug.
Whoa, good shot.
That
nice
was a
move.
Good shot there by
I'll tell
Dusty
you what.
Wolf.
He what an upset.
Over. He comes with one, two, and what a sloppy cover.
Wow, what an upset, though.
He had a slugfest where the world television champion Johnny B. Badd went to the time limit, and they finally ended up shaking hands. But for a while there, it was nip and tuck. I mean, those guys clearly didn't like each other. Eddie Guerrero wanted the world television belt.
Remember, we were out, where were we last week on the road with Prime? We were somewhere out there, the ninth field.
We were
out
in Macon, Georgia.
We were in Macon, Georgia, and we was out there. And remember the two girls came up to us, asked for one autograph from you and me?
Yeah.
The Apple Sisters, remember?
Yeah.
And I said, what's y'all's name? And they said, CD and Corey. What? What? And you went off with CD. Anyway, Dustin Wolf is ragtagging. And he went on with Cora, too. Anyway, I don't want to let that. I don't want to drag our laundry out in the speed here on the Prime.
Well, you know,
Dusty Wolf,
you've heard an apple a day. I figured two apples would.
Hey, listen.
What?
Dusty Wolf has controlled the situation with Eddie Guerrero. Right or wrong?
Well, he has. And that's surprising because Eddie Guerrero is one to take charge. And Dusty Wolf has clearly taken charge of this match. We're a good 5 minutes into this match already. Guerrero now whipped. Oh, man. And Dusty Wolf moves in, but not fast enough. Guerrero with a kick. Look out. He picks up Dusty Wolf. Will he drop him? Oh, almost a brain buster there.
I'll tell you what, he's got him set up now. I believe he's going to go ahead and try to put him away with the jackknife.
I think it's also called the frog slam.
The
one, the jackknife. One, two, and three. It's called successful, and Eddie Guerrero is called a winner in this match here on WCW Prime. When we come back, we'll take you into the dungeon of doom.
Double.
Gotta make my mark.
Well, Dusty, you know, with World War III coming up, the Dungeon of Doom has got two new members, and they are looking forward to perhaps one of the members of the Dungeon of Doom coming out as the new World Heavyweight Champion.
You see that goblet back there?
Yeah.
I told you got to be careful with him, because I'm trying hard to call him up. Watch this. When I call the turkey call, gobble, 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 he don't comprehend that. So I got a special call for him later on the program. Get him up here to do the Moon Match. Speaking of Dungeon of Doom, two new members? Wow.
They call the one-man gang and
gobble,
the man called Hugh Morris. You get it? Humorous,
yeah.
Hugh Morris.
Right.
All members, two new members of the Dungeon of Doom. We got, I think, about 10 seconds left before we go to the Dungeon of Doom.
Well, the Dungeon of Doom is now headed for World War III. And I'm headed for some more turkey calling.
Gobble, 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 gobble.
So then my son, in Detroit, the
taskmaster. 60 men, 3 rings, a giant in each ring. When it's all said and done, when they're all eliminated, and one man stands alone, he will then become the number one contender. As you see, Taskmaster, the Dungeon of Doom has the Dungeon of Doom.
Hold him! Halloween habit. You escape within an inch of your life. A 60-man battle royal. 60 men enter. One man leaves. That one man is the number one contender. Let me tell you something, Hogan. What are you gonna do when that one man from the Dungeon of Doom comes for you? Because I guarantee you, it'll be nothing for you to laugh at.
Dungeon of Doom.
60 men, battle royal.
Friend or foe?
You know, my favorite word in this is World War III, because I was born for war. 60 men in 3 rings, a giant in every ring. Hulk Hogan, you better be afraid, because like he said, only one man will be left, and it will be the one man gang.
It looks like this is a family matter.
Well, as if the Dungeon of Doom wasn't devastating enough, they now have two new members, the one-man gang and Hugh Morris. I thought he was camouflaging. I thought the turkey couldn't see him. Dusty, what are you doing?
I was back there turkey hunting in the back 40 back there here in the pumpkin patch right here on Thanksgiving. So much to be thankful for. Bottom line, Christopher Cruz, thankful of WCW Prime to allow us to be crazy like this. It's a great time of year. We're thankful for a lot of things, but I tell you something that WCW fans are... Not yet.
Hey, is something going on here?
That are grateful for is World War III, and we're talking about Dungeon of Doomers, and we're talking about 3 rings, right?
Yeah.
We're talking about 60 men vying for the most coveted title in the history of wrestling, and that's the WCW World Heavyweight title. I cannot wait for World War III or the Dungeon of Doom. I'll be right back in the middle. I'm Tookie Hunt.
Something's going on here. I know it.
Yeah.
The following feature contest is set for one fall, introducing first from the champion, Rookie Infidel, the Barrio Brothers.
Oh, I like it, Gloria. Nice, bright, cheery music for some pretty dark fellas. Ricky Santana on the right, Fidel Sierra on the left.
Whether you like it or not, learn to live with it.
Quiero que pase aquí. Lo que están mirando son los hermanos de varios. Y estamos Fidel y Ricky Santana. Y vamos a acabar con todo el mundo aquí.
What a mouthful. What a mouthful. Hey, let me tell you something about this great matchup we got going right here on Prime. The Armstrong brothers against the Barrow brothers. This is jockeying for position, my friend. Now let's go back up to our ring announcer.
Your opponents from Marietta, Georgia. Total combined weight, 455 pounds. Scott and Steve, the Armstrong brothers.
Well, you're right, Dust, as always, because this is an opportunity for the Barrio brothers to have really made an impact. The Armstrongs, not sure, I don't think, just where they want to go, other than that they want to be able to face guys like the Harlem Heat, like the Blue Bloods. But in order to do that, as you pointed out, they need to get by the Barrio Brothers and vice versa.
Yeah, you know, that's a give and take and nick and tuck, as we say. A nip and tag, how you call it? Nip and tuck.
Because
the Barrio Brothers have shown that they are really relentless. They are mean, they are angry, and they have the tools. The Armstrong brothers can fly, moving from a great wrestling background. And to a win, see, the importance of this thing is any win moves them closer. But this one here eliminates one of the other guys.
So no guarantee for the winner of this match, what you're saying, but guarantee for the loser in that they will be eliminated from, possibly for some time, for tag team competition here in World Championship Wrestling. And the elbow there by Ricky Santana, very experienced young man in professional wrestling, has wrestled a great deal in Mexico and in Puerto Rico. And he follows Scotty Armstrong outside, who just kind of dives under the bottom rope. Fast-paced match, as we knew it would be. And they're using the ropes, and a spinning kick there by Santana slows down Armstrong.
It was a good move by Santana. Fidel, of course, the bigger guy, and I think the meaner guy, but these guys have really proven that they can stay with the great, good tag team. And right here, they're going to have to beat the Armstrongs if they want to, and vice versa.
Hey, what is that? Scotty Armstrong suckered him, and Steve Armstrong came off the top rope. Look at that. A double drop kick. And Santana tries to hang on. Fidel Sierra comes in, nearly 300 pounds. He goes up and over, and now he's out. He lands on his feet, but look at that. He goes face first onto the floor.
Right now we got an opportunity, you know, all kidding aside and everything, me and you really have a lot of fun here on the Prime. We see the greatest in wrestling.
Yes, we do.
Thanksgiving, right around, I mean, you know, it's important that we all give thanks for the many wonderful things we get. And really, I want to thank Diane and Jay Paul and all of our crew, you know. I'm talking about everybody from the cameraman on up, because nobody in sports do a better job than the people at WCW. Great bunch of people. Just look at yourself and the makeup and everything they give you and everything. How they make that face look like it does standing next to me is phenomenal. But Ed Auburn, what a job Ed Auburn does driving the ring truck. I mean, he is one of the best.
Is that what he does?
Yeah, he is one of the best. No, he's audio. No, he ain't Jay Paul's audio. Ed is, what do you think Ed does?
I don't know. What does he do? He has earphones on.
No, he chases the Apple Sisters.
He chases the Apple Sisters. Yeah, all right.
All right, here we go. Back to the Barrow Brothers. I got that. I meant that, too. Great Thanksgiving time.
Well, Ricky Santana now, a test of strength, and it looks like he's going to win it with the help of Boots. And look at Scotty Armstrong coming right back. Great match this is. The Barrio Brothers against the Armstrongs. We'll take a quick break and be back with the conclusion of this match in a moment. Back to action here on the Prime. Chris Cruz and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And Dusty, it looks like the Armstrong brothers during the break maintained their dominance over the Barrio Brothers.
Yeah, didn't get out of the game plan, because what they did right here was the Barrio Brothers tried to brawl with them a little bit. You know what I mean? And they cut them off, but this big guy right here, I'm talking about Fidel, don't need to be flying like that. He needs to put a stop to this stuff and get on with his beat. Maybe a little clubbering. I'm going to clubber that turkey if he gets close here. A little clubbering.
I thought you needed two people to clubber. Oh,
well, I got you.
I ain't clubbering no turkey.
Sure you are.
I love animals. I ain't clubbering a turkey.
What are we going to eat for Thanksgiving if we don't eat this turkey?
Ham.
Ham? I'm Jewish. I ain't eating no ham.
You're Jewish?
You cowboy.
Well, we'll make it a kosher ham.
There you go.
I guess you can't do that, can you? All right, still to come, Mean Gene Okerlund in the World War III Control Center. Also, Ric Flair in action and Mr. Wonderful.
Hey, already, though, you know, when we talk about pay-per-view, this one's done set up.
Oh, man.
I mean, you talk about the belt being held up and the mood that Hogan's in, and the Giants are running around like crazy, and 60 guys vying for the most coveted title in all of sports, the WCW World Heavyweight title right here on Prime. Whoa! What a shot.
And it's interesting to point out that all of the individual matches, such as Diamond Dallas Page against Johnny B. Badd for the World Television title, such as Ric Flair against Sting, Lex Luger against Macho Man Randy Savage, the participants in all those matches will also be in the 60-man Battle Royal. What a night it's going to be.
Well, somebody be wore out, just like Fidel is wearing out the Armstrongs right now. As we were filibustering right there about World War III, they have come on to the self right here, turned it around, as I said. The big guy made the stop. Now, Ricky Santana's in there, got to keep the locomotion going for the Bio Brothers to get a win here on WCW Prime.
And that's exactly what Santana is doing. He's maintaining his bodily contact there with Steve Armstrong. He gets up on the second rope now. He's taking his time, though. He better be careful. Armstrong, yo! He did just what we thought he might do.
What was that?
He defended his position.
Good call!
Balog crew. He defended his position.
And now let's see if he can get some offense from his brother Scotty. And Scotty comes in on fire. Oh, he's looking for people to beat up. He found two of them. And Fidel, never wanted to back off from a fight, comes in. Oh, no. Double noggin knocker. They get him, Dusty.
Yeah, they got them both staggered right now. All four men in the ring right here on WCW Prime. They're getting ready to call up the dogs, I think, right here on them. Whoa, what happened here? Whoop.
Well, I believe it's Ricky Santana and Scotty Armstrong who are the legal men in the ring. Steve Armstrong dumped out.
Watch
and
out.
Santana, look out.
Uh-oh, looks like some type of double team going to go on here now. Picked him up, got him. Going for the roll-up, Ricky.
Whoa, Santana's got him.
Hey.
Steve Armstrong comes in. He's got a bulldog on Santana. Scott Armstrong rolls over, hooks the leg, gets one, two, and three.
Oh, man. Wow.
Scott and Steve.
What a simple twist of fate that was.
Brothers.
As Bob Dylan would say, what a simple twist of fate. Like thieves in the night, Armstrong escaped with a victory.
Right back with Mean Gene in the World War III Control Center.
Gobble, gobble. That's Rosie McAdream, Christopher Cruz, big Thanksgiving special on WCW Prime. Anything to say to the fans out there? I got a live turkey right here.
There's Sunday night, only on pay-per-view, it's World War III. Hi again, I'm Gene Okerlund, back in the control center with the tremendous lineup on tap for this weekend. May I recommend that you call your cable company now regarding availability. Satellite dish owners contact Turner Premier, also presented on DirecTV. Now then, for the first time ever, an incredible three-ring 60-man over-the-top rope battle royal with the winner to be crowned the new WCW heavyweight champion. That prestigious title is being held up by Commissioner Nick Bockwinkel. With the stakes being as high as they are, virtually every top superstar in the world, save maybe one, maybe two men, all are entered in this unique competition. First and foremost, the former champion, Hulk Hogan, will endeavor to regain the title. What's the man who momentarily laid claim to the belt, the 7'3" giant? Also entered are Sting, Lex Luger, the Muscle Man, Randy Savage, Shark, Disco Inferno, Big Bubba, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, BK Wall Street, Arn Anderson, Ric Flair, Sergeant Craig Pittman, Mr. Wonderful, Johnny B. Badd, the Harlem Heat, Bunkhouse Buck and Dirty Dick Slater, Kurosawa, Eddie Guerrero, Diamond Dallas Page, Cobra, the Nasty Boys, the American Males, Ming, Brian Bryan, the Blue Bloods, Chris Benoit, Renegade, Road Warrior Hawk, Alex Wright, JL, Sabu, Yete, plus just added from Great Britain, Dave Taylor, Hugh Morris, and the Super Assassins number one and number two. In addition, Lex Luger will lock up in a singles match with the Macho Man, Randy Savage. From Japan, women wrestlers Bull Nakano and Akira Hokuto will meet Cutie Suzuki and Mayumi Ozaki. Expect a collision as Sting squares off against the Nature Boy, Ric Flair. Big Bubba and Hacksaw Jim Duggan duke it out in a tape fist match. World Television champ Johnny B. Badd defends against Diamond Dallas Page, who's put the Diamond Doll up for grabs in his effort to regain that title. And in light of the events that occurred earlier this week in Japan, new U.S. champion Kensuke Sasaki will defend against Chris Benoit. It doesn't get any better than this Sunday. A gigantic three-ring, 60-man battle royal. The last man in that ring crowd, the new WCW World Heavyweight Champion. World War III, live from Norfolk, Virginia, available exclusively on pay-per-view. Satellite dish owners contact Turner Premier, also available on DirecTV. This Sunday evening, 7 o'clock Eastern, 4 out of the West Coast, it's World War III. Don't miss it.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
Out of the shadows of a fearful city rises Spawn. Infinite powers are yours. Enemies are everywhere. It's over 40 stages straight from the hit comic Todd McFarlane's Spawn, the video game.
You pull off the mask. What I like to snap best? Arms? Legs? I like a baby spicy Slim Jim. Step into it, yeah!
It's Godzilla, king of all monsters, against the baddest beasts of all time. It's all-out Godzilla war. Godzilla figures from Trendmasters. Godzilla rules. Two men enter the future with one mission. Destroy the other first. Armed with awesome firepower, battle through 10 intense levels straight from this movie mega hit. Demolition Man, the future's only hope from Acclaim.
McAdoo, Dusty Rose, and Christopher Cruz, WCW Prime Thanksgiving Special. You know what turkeys we do to them at Thanksgiving? You know, we eat them? Yep. Maybe the turkey would like to do that to you, because I'm camouflaged. Would you like that turkey?
What?
Yes, yes! Thanksgiving Special on Prime.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following contest is set for one fall. Introducing first, from Charlotte, North Carolina, weighing 242 pounds, representing the Horsemen, Nature Boy, Rick Flair.
All right, Dusty, let's be fair and forthcoming at the outset. You are not going to be able to call the match involving Ric Flair in a fair and impartial way.
Well, I beg to differ with you. I beg to differ with you, and I'll tell you why right after we get this ring announcement from Dave Pinder.
This woman from Portland, Oregon, weighing 218 pounds, Bart Sawyer.
You're supposed to swallow that last O.
Listen.
Not Oregon, Oregon.
Listen.
Listen.
Bottom line with this situation right here on WCW Prime, the finest watch wrestling program anywhere. Due largely to our lady producer. Women are running rampant in television, making a name for herself, and she loved me. She said, be impartial. Call it down the middle. You are now a paid announcer for WCW Prime. So I will attempt to call it right down the middle as the Nature Boy, lowlife, sniggity grab, good for another cheetah, wrestler Bart Sawyer. And Bart Sawyer don't stand a challenge chance in Hades, a women's match. What he can do is learn and really try to go to school with the Nature Boy.
And Bart Sawyer takes the Nature Boy over, and the Nature Boy with a two count very quickly, just seconds in, as you can see in the background, Flying Brian Pillman, one of the four horsemen, who we now know to be Flying Brian, Ric Flair, Arn Anderson, and Chris Benoit.
Well, two of the originals, you know, and bottom line with this situation right here is wondering what the Nature Boy is going to do. Being able to tune in, prime, and see 11-time World Heavyweight Champion and Nature Boy, Ric Flair, beaten three times by the American Dusty Rhodes. Anyway, see him right here on the Prime is an opportunity to see greatness in action and see maybe Bart Sawyer, if he can do what needs to be done to pull the biggest upset in the history of wrestling, would be right. That's why we watch Prime right here. That's it. Prime. And these turkeys. Behind the tree. Quack. Okay, he's gone.
Oh, can I call the action now?
Yes. I call the turkey.
You call the turkey?
Okay.
I call the action. I get you.
I'll teach you a turkey call here in a minute.
All right,
let's watch it.
What a chop there by the Nature Boy, who comes up with a right, a 242-pounder from Charlotte, North Carolina, ostensibly one of North Carolina's most prominent citizens. You know, more people in North Carolina know Ric Flair than know the government.
Did you know that?
Where? In North Carolina.
Oh, yeah.
Brian Pillman now chopping and choking Bart Sawyer.
More people in North Carolina know the magazine Dusty Rhodes than Ric Flair. What does that make me? Even higher than the governor.
Higher than the governor.
Yeah, and that's all because WCW Prime. Hey, Christopher Cruz, I know you live in North Carolina.
Yeah.
Got your big real estate office going there. What a great opportunity for me to get all that information every week when I'm off the air. I bought two houses and both of them burned down, and I'm
broke. Collecting the insurance.
Yeah.
Still paying the mortgage, though, aren't you?
Here we go. Watch your Bart.
Oh, man.
Right here. What's he doing?
Well, we clearly know what he's doing, and that is he's weakening that knee for the figure four leg lock, which he can put on at any time. That's the move that the Nature Boy won many of those World Heavyweight Championships with.
Well, I've been in that situation where he took that thing on me, brother. A lot of pain, bruising, and agony went through my leg. And I know for a fact the first thing that I did after our first or second encounter with the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, was I learned the figure four leg lock. And I went to Jack Briscoe and Eddie Graham, and I said, teach me this thing. Teach me how to counter this thing. Because when he puts it on me, I want to be able to get out of it, and I want to be able to put it on him. And if you will go back and date the history of me and the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, I put it on him as much as he put it on me, because I knew I had to learn that. Bart Sawyer, if he leaves here with something and goes and says, teach me how to do this, sooner or later, maybe someday, he'll be able to pull a victory and upset over a man like Nature Boy, Ric Flair. You got to learn from your mistakes.
Bart Sawyer now trying to break the hold.
That was great commentary there, because I told a hell of a story.
I was like, you just ran with it.
Well, anyway.
Do you think I would interrupt you?
Are you ready to learn the turkey call after
yes,
this
sir.
Match? After this match, I'll teach you.
We got the prime match of the week next.
I know it, but I mean, right here
when this thing, it ain't, I guarantee this match ain't going to go an hour. We ain't going to see an hour draw here. If we are, I'm going to go out and get me something to drink, coffee or something. You know what I'm talking about?
To
celebrate Thanksgiving. But I want to teach you a turkey call. We got to get this turkey up. I got to get him up by the end of the program. Out of the bushes.
You got plans for this.
I got a plan for this turkey.
As we said, still to come in our prime match of the week, Mr. Wonderful takes on the Cobra.
You think we could get the turkey up close enough to have him do a move? Can you imagine a turkey move? If you could call him up close enough for him to move.
It's biologically impossible.
In the move match?
Remember when we had the ghost doing the move?
That's it.
Remember he did it too soon? And he said, not now.
Wow, not now for the Nature Boy Ric Flair either. Really going to school with Bart Sawyer.
Bart Sawyer has served really as a punching bag for the last 6 minutes.
Yeah, but he's had to learn just being in there with the Nature Boy Ric Flair, being here on WCW Prime, being part of this place where the big boys play, getting ready for World War III, 60 men. I mean, we unloading the pay-per-view on them. I guarantee you one thing, Hulkamania is going to be right and ready, my friend. What happened?
Sawyer is fighting both men as if Flair were not intimidated.
What Sawyer is fighting is that leg is really paining him right now. Uh-oh. Got him set. Here you go.
Flair, a very methodical, mechanical wrestler when he needs to be, and he is taking apart Mark Sawyer piece by piece, specifically that left knee. Knees are usually, Dusty, as you know, one of the weak points of any professional wrestler, and it looks like Ric Flair is making good use of that information.
There you go. Got
him
hooked up.
Right in the middle of the ring, he cinches it in. You hear Sawyer screaming in pain and says yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match, Nature Boy, Ric Flair.
All right, that's a great victory. We got to get this turkey up for this prime match move. Okay, now I want to teach you the turkey call. You ready?
Ready.
Get back on your hunches. Okay, on your hunches. Get out.
Okay.
Are you ready? All right, now call out the turkey sound. You know what it is?
We're back on the Prime, Chris Cruz and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And Dusty, time now for our Prime match of the week. It involves a somewhat discouraged Mr. Wonderful.
Hey, you didn't believe me when I say I can call a turkey up. All I got to do is use the right turkey call. And thousands of people went to call a turkey. They said, Chris Cruz. See how he reacts to that? I have got a turkey, I promise. He's right here, right in front of us. And right now, the world, don't peck him. Do not peck him.
Yeah,
when
don't peck me.
Listen, and right now, in front of the whole world, this turkey right here will bring us the move match of the week. You said turkeys can't move.
Turkeys can't move.
This turkey can move. Okay, turkey, I'm going to give you a countdown for the move match of the week. It's Mr. Wonderful, right or wrong?
Right.
Yes, sir, and he is a little distraught. Move match of the week. Okay, turkey.
You did it.
What?
You made a turkey move.
Of course I did. But the call's what got him up. The turkey call. That's what got him up. Speaking of getting up right here, Cobra. Cobra right now is in a position to take Mr. Wonderful to the post because Mr. Wonderful is destroyed right around Thanksgiving.
Mr. Wonderful has had his mirror smashed. What he did is he turned his back to Johnny B. Badd, and Johnny B. Badd drop-kicked him right over the top rope, smashing his mirror, and now Mr. Wonderful is convinced that his life is messed up and will be messed up for the next 7 years.
Wow.
And there is that distinctive music now.
Are you kidding?
Some say the stinky music, but the distinctive music.
You were just talking about messed up. Oh, look at his face.
He's got no self-confidence.
Well, I'll tell you what, this music is
low self-esteem. It's
something sounds wrong.
No, it's wow, listen at it. Look at it.
Look at him.
Yeah, no lie. That's a
Little Mermaid just left the building.
I knew it was something you was bad luck.
Oh, man.
Listen to my music, it broke.
Nothing's working for the
guy. No. I'll tell you what. Oh, God.
7 years of bad luck. 7 years is more than a lifetime in pro wrestling, Dustin.
Cut
this
it
is
off.
A man, the Brandon Bull, who's been wrestling more than 20 years. How is it you come to that after nearly a quarter century of wrestling? How is it you come to this point where you no longer have self-confidence, no longer have any self-esteem? Mr. Wonderful to take on the Cobra, or as he is sometimes called, the Corba. That's because some people have trouble with the consonants there. Well, Mr. Wonderful is having trouble. Mr. Wonderful is just plain having trouble getting off his ring attire. Is he even going to wrestle here?
Well, yeah, and the other thing about him is that he had a psychic hotline guy. You know what I mean?
Right, psychic companion.
Yeah, and he told him straighten up, and he had him going on the right road. And then Mr. Wonderful, broken windows, broken me, if you will, and his whole mindset changed. Now no confidence. So what I was saying the first of this match right here on the Prime Cut Match of the Week is that Cobra can beat him when he's in this state of mind.
And Cobra, certainly a relative unknown when you compare him to Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff. And as you pointed out before, in these matches, anything can happen. It's just 3 seconds away from a conclusion. And look at how I mean, have you ever seen Mr. Wonderful look anything less than 100%?
No, Mr. Wonderful has all the tools to get major titles put around his waist, and he's held major titles in the past. But lately, he has depended on...
Flying cross, body block.
I told you. Oh, yeah, he's depended on somebody to tell him how good he is and not use that self-confidence that he was always full of. And I guarantee you he's in dire straits right now.
Two beautiful drop kicks there by the Cobra. And he tries to hook the leg, and Orndorff kind of...
Oh.
Yeah, almost feel sorry for this
guy.
My
music's so bad.
Yeah, I know.
The mirror's broken.
My music...
Where's Gary Spivey?
My music gone bad. My mirror's broken.
Where's Mr. Wonderful?
And where's Gary Spivey? Where's Mr. Wonderful?
He
that's fourth thing he don't know where they are.
He can't seem to reach his psychic companion. The guy with the funny hair, Gary Spivey, if that's hair. And Cobra, I think, Dusty, you might agree, seems to be making a mistake by not going after Orndorff. Orndorff clobbering the, clobbering, I beg your pardon, the ring announcer.
He's made a mistake because he needs to be on the offense. You see these disarrayed, this drunk.
And we're back on the prime. Now let's go to the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following feature contest.
Get it, Dave.
Six-man tag team action is set for one fall. Introducing first, from Charlotte, North Carolina, Nature Boy.
There he was. And there comes Double A.
His tag team partner from Minnesota.
You're not going to let poor Dave Pedger do his job, are you?
Anderson.
This is not radio, my friend. This is television.
California, Flying Ryan.
Of the four horsemen, Dusty, here on the prime.
Yes, this should be a great matchup. WCW Prime bringing you a big six-man tag team matchup with three, as you said, of the new Nananas. Four horsemen, all machine ready to go.
Of course, the fourth, recently announced here in World Championship Wrestling, the Canadian Crippler, Chris Benoit. The somewhat interchangeable horseman. When you sign a contract with a horseman, you never know who you're going to get.
You never know who you're going to get.
As opponents, it could be Flair, Anderson, and Pillman. It could be Flair, Anderson, Benoit. Could be, well, let's see who their opponents are now.
Opponents first from Daytona Beach, Florida.
The Owl
accompanied
to do
by
his
Ralph
job.
The Rabbit, Dave Sullivan.
The Rabbit.
His tag team partner from Baltimore, Maryland.
That
Sullivan,
wasn't a Rabbit.
Joey Beggs. And their tag team partner from Parts Unknown,
I think you probably got to say, Dusty, that the real star of this team is the one that we know the least about. The man by the name of Mr. GL. JL, I mean.
Jay Leno, he said.
No,
he didn't say Jay Leno?
No, he said JL. I don't think, because when we get a shot of JL, you'll see that his jaw is actually normal size.
I'll tell you what, he's a great athlete. I've seen him in action. You have too.
Yes.
We've both had an occasion to see him. He really matches up well against the likes of a Brian Pillman when you're talking about a matchup. And you're looking at Joey Maggs that might match up a little bit against Iron. And then we look at Dave Sullivan, who does not match up with any of them, except the bottom line is he possesses more strength and speed and power.
The power of the rabbit right here on the prime. It's WCW Prime, Chris Cruz and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And we are coming at you from the Disney MGM studios this week. And Dusty, I think Dave Sullivan is looking for the hutch for Ralph the Rabbit, his personal, financial, emotional, and professional advisor.
The what? The hutch.
The hutch.
The rabbit hutch.
Very good. This is going to be a good matchup on Prime.
Well, we got, like I said, we got so many letters about our program. And you know, a lot of the letters come from executives that are ladies. You know what I mean? Because they are so curious. When I talk about Diane, our producer, and our friendship and our love between me and her and how we get along and bring new announcers with me on here, give them tryouts and stuff, they all letters are saying, man, it must be really something to for Diane to get so high up in a company like, you know, right here with WCW Prime World Championship Wrestling. And I say, well, it's knowledge and it's who you know. You know what I mean?
Ric Flair then shoulder block, football tackle there by Jumpin' Joey Maggs, who has been scouted as of late here in World Championship Wrestling by none other than former WCW Manager of the Year, Teddy Long, who, frankly, Dusty, we thought was inactive.
Was what?
Oh, was inactive.
That's active right there. That's inactive.
That is reactive. Whoa, man. A straight right there by Flair, the former 11-time heavyweight champion of the world. Now the push into the ropes, and Flair with a shoulder block of his own. Drop toe hold, no. And Flair can't tag out to Pillman or Anderson.
Well, he came off that with so much speed that Joey caught him right there. You see, I look at Teddy Long, you mentioned him, and Teddy Long has really been trying to get in the ear of this young man we're seeing right here.
There is the sense, I think, from Teddy Long that there is some wasted potential here on the part of
Jumpin' Joey Maggs.
Jumpin' Joey Maggs.
Yes, sir,
yes.
You're right. Absolutely.
JL comes in.
Jay Leno will get our first shot. Look at him.
Would you please stop it? That's right. Stop it. Because
well,
that's not Jay Leno.
You might see anybody on the prime.
Well, that's true.
We've seen turkeys, right?
We've seen goblins.
Yes, we've seen everything. We've seen Godden, Eric, Tony, and
here
now the
again.
Legendary Christopher.
Oh, man, and Anderson misses. Oh, look at JL just picks him up and dumps him. His first nice drop kick by the mysterious Mr. JL. We're right in the middle of some great action here on WCW Prime. Chris Cruz and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And we're going to take a very quick break. We'll be back with more six-man action in a moment. To action here on WCW Prime. Ric Flair, a blatant chokehold there. On Jumpin' Joey Maggs. It's a six-man tag team event. Dave Sullivan, Mr. JL, and Jumpin' Joey Maggs, who's being scouted by this man, Teddy Long, against three of the four horsemen. Ric Flair, Arn Anderson, and Flyin' Brian Pillman. The four horsemen, Chris Benoit, we'll see a little bit later in the program.
Well, you know, scouting's not the word. It's true, though, but I talked to Teddy, and you have too, before I went on. And Teddy, like you had brought up earlier, has a real interest in this kid. And what he sees potentially-wise inside of him. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Wanting to bring it out. Whether win or lose is not important to him. It's just something he sees in him. But he's here, interested party. But you got six men and three of them are horsemen out here. You got a lot going on right here on the prime. You know, second match of the day right here. And this is exciting time for us. Aren't it?
It sure is, as Joey Maggs trying to find his way out.
Did you hear that word I used? Arn it?
I thought you were talking about Arn it Anderson.
Yeah, I was.
Oh, you aren't.
Arn it.
Dave Sullivan has yet to make an appearance here in this six-man event. This is, Joey Maggs there with a snap there. This is an opportune time for Sullivan to try to make his mark on some of the horsemen.
If I had a telestrator like John Madden, you know what I mean? I've been begging Dan to give me one of them. Right now, we could stop the action, and I can show you a guy in the stands, but I can't do it with my finger because they don't show up on there. I can show you a guy in the stands that looks... I mean, I gotta explain it.
Looks like Diane?
No. How about a
woman in the stands that looks like Diane?
No, this is something I wanted you to see, but the guy's already gone. Whoa!
That's a punt from the former Cincinnati Bengal.
Don't
there.
You think I need a telestrator?
I absolutely do.
Yeah. No, but you know, I never seen him wrestling
but
before.
But Diane is kind of a tough boss, isn't she?
Yes.
You know? Oh, we can call it the WCW chalkboard.
I had to go over her house personally to get my check one day.
Are you serious?
I ain't lying, bro.
I get mine FedEx to me.
When?
Well, not often.
But she don't want to see your mug over there at her face at her house.
You know where she lives?
Stop
the security
it. Let's
guard
look
you
it.
In?
Joy, stop it.
You tell me to stop it. You started it.
Don't drag my laundry out in the street.
I am.
way. Whoa.
All
what
right
a
there
shot.
By jumping Joey Maggs. Now the, oh no,
a reversal by Anderson. Oh. And look at that.
Until then,
the spine buster.
And Anderson's going to get him.
No, he ain't.
No, he's not. You're right. No, he aren't.
The enforcer, enforcer.
And finally, Sullivan makes his entrance, and he is quickly dumped out. And jumping Joey Maggs says, I give up. Too painful. Disappointed and some might say disgusted Teddy Long, who believes that jumping Joey Maggs has a lot more in him than we just saw in this six-man event.
You know what I think, Chris, too, is there was an opportunity to put him within two pretty good players when I'm talking about Sullivan and JL. And there he was to see how he reacted in the situation against the Nature Boy Ric Flair and three of the Horsemen. And obviously Teddy Long didn't really get out of it what he wanted. Maybe, I don't know. But bottom line here is, we have seen on the prime three of the most awesome forces of the night, as they say, of the four horsemen. Right there, you see a shot to Joey Maggs. And then right here, the enforcer eliminates Joey Maggs, but does not make the cover, as you said. Makes the tag so the Nation can get all the glory. Been doing it for years. A walk behind her, Iron Anderson, letting the Nature Boy take the figure four and throw it on Joey Maggs. I would just flip that over. I've done that before.
I'm sure you have, but
yeah,
Joey
I've been
Maggs,
in a lot of pain with that.
Not nearly at the level of the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. We still got a whole lot more to come here on WCW Prime. We're going to see the fourth horseman, Chris Benoit. We're also going to see Eddie Guerrero. The Super Assassins will be here against the American Males. And a whole lot more as we continue on the Prime in a moment. Dusty, we're about to see Chris Benoit in action. He's the newest member of the Four Horsemen. But before we do that, we're going to see the master of a thousand holds, Dean Malenko. I call him the Iceman sometimes. He's, in fact, at one time has been a partner of Chris Benoit. He's going to kind of give us a wrestling clinic.
Well, he can put a clinic on. And I hear that he is going to show us the Texas cloverleaf. And it was many years growing up as a child in Texas before I didn't understand. Texas cloverleaf was always a dance to me. I put a bunch of people out on the dance floor at Big G's there in Round Rock and just have a big time. But now I find out it can break your leg. I don't want nothing to do with it at my age.
All right, let's take you now to the master of a thousand holds.
My name is Dean Malenko. I am the man of a thousand holds. Right now I'd like to illustrate just one of those holds for you. This hold I call the Texas Cloverleaf. It puts pressure on the knee joint and the lower back area. You know, this is just a demonstration.
Yes, I do.
I can have you just lay down on your back here. Getting both of the feet, applying a figure four, using your arms, clasping your hands together. You're turning them over.
Yeah! Yeah!
You able to feel that?
Oh, yeah. Never found out like that before.
Remember, I'm the man of a thousand holes. That was just one.
Back on WCW Prime, Chris Cruz and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And Dusty, we're about to see the fourth horseman, the Canadian crippler, Chris Benoit, making his entrance here to the Disney MGM studio.
I want to say a little something about the cloverleaf, Texas cloverleaf. And that was designed down the way it got the word Texas. Obviously, from Texas cloverleaf, that's a devastating move. Dean Malenko, this guy can be lethal, if you know what I'm talking about.
Now, the scary thing is, the master of a thousand holds always points out that that is one of his holds, and he knows 999 more and possibly more than that. So just one hold can cripple you.
Well, that was the girl in Austin. Back to the prime.
Yeah, indeed, back to the prime. And now,
this crowd is going crazy. Whoa, what a shot right there.
A chop from Benoit that levels Otis Apollo.
Who?
Otis Apollo.
Otis Apollo.
Houston, this is...
Oh, yeah, I like that. Otis Apollo.
Yeah, you like that. Yeah, see, Apollo 14. You get... Oh, man. They're running lariat. I caught one in on you, didn't I?
You got that one. That was good. This guy's got a great deal of... A great amount of athletic ability. I guarantee that much. Chris Benoit. It's hard to say when you talk about I call him the little tigers, you know, that's come in here lately to play with the big boys play. When you take a look at Dean Malenko, take a look at Chris Benoit, and I don't mean that as stature-wise, and Eddie Guerrero, and they say, which one is pound for pound the best? You know what I mean? And I guarantee all three of them, you throw them in there. I'd like to see them in a round robin.
Well, we have seen, in fact, Chris Benoit take on, snap suplex there, take on Eddie Guerrero, and at one time, one of their matches ended when they were both counted out. They essentially knocked one another out and had to have the trainer come in and try to revive them with some smelling salts. So, in fact, we're going to see Eddie Guerrero a little bit later here on WCW Prime. Chris Benoit setting up Otis Apollo. Now the whip from the Horseman and a running elbow. Wow.
Well, he's got so much ability, you know, Chris Benoit, and to be chosen the fourth horseman, you know what I mean? I know there were a lot of negotiations going in there. They wanted somebody that was maybe a little bit meaner. Malenko can break an arm, break a leg at Sting or Hogan, everybody can in our industry. But this guy seemed to have that. He fits well with Pillman. He fits well with the 90s, Chris.
In fact, a lot of people think that Pillman and Benoit will turn out to be the tag team of the 90s as the Horsemen go on their... look at that! High back body drop. Go on their quest to bring in belts into the family of the Four Horsemen. And look at Apollo. No. He misses the elbow and misses big.
Well, that was a game plan that Flair had when he took Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson. Not so much a Flair had that James J. Dillon had at that point in time that guided the Horsemen.
Oh, Dusty, this could be it. It is. 1, 2, 3.
Well, he had that. Let me give my thought there. He had that ability to say, okay, Tully, you and I are going to win the World Tag Team Champions. Nature Boy going to win the World Heavyweight title. You know what I mean? Lex Luger going to win the U.S. title. And that's the way it was done. And I think you were right by putting that point
for the ride of your life
on these guys right here. I'm talking about Pillman and Chris Benoit.
Pillman and Chris Benoit teaming up, and then Arn Anderson, who knows what he'll go for, and Ric Flair, I guess, will try to get the World's Heavyweight Championship back. And let's see this again, Dusty.
Well, it's just pure power and strength, and if Malenko know 1,000 holds, this guy know 999 of, I mean, he is so good and so quick, and we see a great victory here for one of the Horsemen.
And Benoit with a full Nelson and bridges over Otis Apollo and gets the 1-2-3. Another great victory for the fourth member of the Four Horsemen. And we're back here on WCW Prime in a moment. Fans, we're about to see Diamond Dallas Page in action, but Dusty, before we do that, we're now going to take the fans to a member of World Championship Wrestling who's actually been honored by former President Jimmy Carter.
Well, Teddy Long is a man that is long, if you will, in community service. And Teddy Long is a fine young man, and we're going to get an opportunity now to go in depth with him, if you will, close up.
Now we take you to a conversation between Teddy Long and Tony Schiavone.
Frequently on my travels all across the United States, I hear the question many times, where is Teddy Long? And fans, as you can see, he has joined me this week. Teddy Long started out as a referee. If you'll recall years ago when I did the program from the studios on Techwood Drive in Atlanta on WCW Saturday night, Teddy was a referee. Then he made the smooth transition, the successful transition, into a manager. As a matter of fact, Teddy, one of the most successful managers of all time, was at one time Professional Wrestling Manager of the Year. But that's all in the past. And people have been wondering, what's Teddy Long doing now?
Well, Tony Schiavone, let me thank you for having me here. And let me say what Teddy Long's been doing. I thought about all the violence and all the drugs and all the negative stuff that our young kids are getting involved in. So I said to myself, maybe I need to go out and I need to reach out and start talking to these young kids and tell them how to become positive. But I thought that I needed to go out, reach out to them, start talking to them about, you know, stay in school, get an education, don't join no gangs, stop the violence, don't be picking up no guns, don't be doing no killing, you know, and let these kids know that there is another way out, and that is the positive way. So that's where I've been for the last couple of years, is in the communities, talking to the kids, and doing what I can do to help get them on the right track.
And, of course, the communities have responded to Teddy Long. As a matter of fact, recently in Atlanta, the mayor of Atlanta, Bill Campbell, proclaimed it Teddy Long Day. Let's take a look at that footage.
Atlanta has been blessed with many people that have helped our city, and particularly the children of our city. But I can think of none more deserving than special recognition than Teddy Long. So on behalf of the city council and the mayor and all the people of Atlanta who love you, love what you do, and love what you stand for, we want to proclaim today in our city as Teddy Long Day, and to say thank you for the people of Atlanta.
Teddy, that was a big moment, not only for World Championship Wrestling, but for you also, I know.
It certainly was, Tony, and let me thank Mayor Bill Campbell once again.
Let's talk about some of the other celebrities that I know that have worked with you on many of your efforts.
Well, James Brown has been very supportive of me. We led off a big campaign about stopping the violence over in the Herndon Home Housing Project. Danny Glover is another guy that gave me a lot of support. Also former President Carter, you know, I walked the streets of Atlanta with him, and he gave me a lot of support.
Now, recently, we are seeing you at ringside watching matches. We've seen you watching matches involving Jumping Joey Maggs. Tell us what you're thinking and what's going on in your mind when you're at ringside now.
Well, Tony, you know, doing my community work, I still watch the program on the TV every week, and, you know, and I see now in WCW, you know, there's a lot of young talent. I've been in this business for 10 years, and I know this business, and I see myself taking, you know, some of the young talent here in WCW and making them become winners. And so what I'm doing right now is I'm just coming out, I'm just watching matches, and, you know, I don't know, pretty soon maybe I'll decide on who I'd like to maybe take under my wing and make them a big superstar here in WCW.
Okay, we look forward to that day. Our thanks to Teddy Long with us this week. And Teddy, thanks a lot. We look forward to seeing you on TV a lot more.
Thank you so much, Tony. Baby!
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
Out of the shadows of a fearful city rises Spawn. Infinite powers are yours. Enemies are everywhere. It's over 40 stages straight from the hit comic Todd McFarlane's Spawn, the video game.
You are getting very, very sleepy, uh-huh. Now step out of it! It's Devin old baby, spicy Slim Jim, oh yeah!
It's Godzilla, king of all monsters, against the baddest beasts of all time. It's all-out Godzilla War. Godzilla figures from Trendmasters. Godzilla rules. With Erector sets, you can build cool trucks, hot racers, and fantastic flying machines, or anything else you can dream up. It's amazing what you and Erector can do.
Have mercy!
And we're back on WCW Prime. Chris Cruz and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and Dusty Teddy Long with his wrestling rap, trying to make it back here in a World Championship Wrestling and make it big. One might say that at one time, as a manager, he ruled WCW, the manager of the year.
Well, he's a good man, I guarantee you.
Dallas Page, the former World Television Champion, making his, what he believes, his triumphant appearance. An entrance here into World Championship Wrestling that is the MGM Studios. He's stolen the Bad Blaster, and that's got to be really ticking Johnny B. Bad off. And making them upset, too. He's going to face Dusty, a man by the name of the Rockin' Rebel, Chuck Williams. Oddly enough, he's from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Well, they got rebels up there in Philadelphia, you know.
In fact, you might say that that's where this whole rebellion started that created the United States of America.
Oh, my God, don't even start that.
What do you mean? That's where the rebels started, the revolutionaries.
I just said there's a lot of rebels up there, you know. Good friend of mine, you know. George Thurgood, the Destroyer's up from that era,
yeah,
right there, you know?
Yeah.
There's a lot of rebels up there.
Oh, I was just validating what you said. Not that that's necessary.
Well, you talk about an athlete that's really coming to his own at WCW. It is DDP, Dallas Page.
Who started in wrestling as a manager, and I asked him one time why he became a wrestler, and he said, hey, simple, I could wrestle better than the guys I used to manage, and he is slowly but surely proving that.
Okay, baby, don't quit your day job, kid.
Did you hear that? Don't quit your day job. Well, the Rockin' Rebel, huh?
Who was he talking to?
He's talking to Rebel.
Oh.
He's talking to you.
I wasn't sure.
WCW Prime, I mean, we have watched him, you know, we have watched him really mature. I'm talking about Dallas Page as an athlete with the big boys play. WCW right here on Prime. And for the Rebel to win this thing, he's going to have to get Dallas quick. And it ain't going to happen right now. So he's got to regroup.
A pull of the hair right in front of the referee, and the Rebel is making a mistake. Oh, no, he's not. He moved right in. Oh, and got a right to the side of the face.
He left his head on me. He's vulnerable. He left his head where you become vulnerable, and you can be nailed right there when you're real vulnerable like he was.
Oh, man, look at the strength of Diamond Dallas Page, who dumps the Rockin' Rebel and says, give me a 10, give me a 10. He's signaling something of a diamond. I'm not sure if it's the diamond cutter coming up or what.
Well, since he come in with all that money, or whatever happened with all that money, he has got a lot of diamonds. And
that is a diamond cutter. One of the diamonds DDP has, and gets the 1, 2, 3. And what will he get? A 10 plus, I guess. And he gives Chuck Williams, the Rockin' Rebel, a 0. Chuck Williams is probably out of it after that diamond cutter. Doesn't know he's got the 0.
Johnny B. Bad, I want the gold you stole from me.
Yeah.
You never beat me.
I'll tell you what, bottom line is, there'll be more titles down the road for Diamond Dallas Page. I guarantee that.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Hall of
contest is set for one fall. Introducing first, from El Paso, Texas,
Dean Malenko, one of Eddie Guerrero's frequent opponents. I guess we need to thank him for showing us what a hyperextension of the knee is. Now it's back to the ring.
Oxford, Connecticut, Buck Quartermain.
The master of 1,000 holds, and he indicates that that is just one of them.
Well, he knows it all, but I guarantee you one thing. This is my man right here from El Paso, Texas. I'm talking about second generation, as you call it many times, the great garden foley. You can talk about this. This kid right here, Eddie Guerrero, has got all the tools. I guarantee you, he can be with a bigger guy, a smaller guy, whatever it takes, he can get it done.
There does seem to be somewhat of an advantage to being a second generation wrestler, having grown up seeing your father, or in some cases, frankly, your mother, operating in this very difficult, very brutal world that we call professional wrestling. Oh, man! Where did that come from?
Well, he's just quick as a cat. He's an opportunist, and he's an opportune time right there, and I guarantee you, he doesn't waste a lot of time in there.
Look at that! Only Eddie Guerrero could do a move like that. He flips himself over the rope, and then a very low snapmare rolls over one. No, just a one count. Buck Quartermain able to kick out. He's a strong, good-looking, in-shape young man, but he doesn't have nearly the experience that Eddie Guerrero has. Now the Irish whip into the ropes. Guerrero is clocked with an elbow. Quartermain, no, doesn't even get the one count, even though he hooks the leg.
Well, Quartermain, you know, really tried to mount some offense right there, but wow, what an uppercut that was. Really took his head off, put it on the back of his shoulders right there, and Eddie Guerrero felt the wrath of Quartermain there just for a little bit, and he said, hey, I got to go ahead and do my business here. Well, you take care of business, and that business is taken care of right here on the prime.
After a gut wrench, what?
A what?
A gut wrench. A suplex there by Eddie Guerrero. He gets him over. I told you I know these holds. And then Guerrero moves in and just body first smashes into Buck Quartermain. And he's got his confidence back. He's saying, come on, I can do this. Now the whip, no, the reversal from Quartermain, who moves in, but no, goes over the top, blocks the right from Guerrero.
That was a good block.
With his own, good block. He's up. Shades of Eddie Guerrero himself. High cross body block, 1-2. Off the top rope. Nice move from Quartermain.
See some nice moves from Quartermain, as you said. Looks like a fine athlete. He's going to go back up again, and I guarantee you now, he's got him in a position not to make a mistake, and I believe he did by going, whoa, 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 whoa.
I think we're going to see a suplex here from Eddie Guerrero. A superplex make that off the very top rope. He's got it. Slam right down on the mat. And now look at Guerrero signaling for the frog splash. Will he do that, or will he come up with another of his many finishing maneuvers?
Well, he's got him set up right there. Nice suplex. Good, solid suplex right there. Going up top now.
This is going to do it, where he jackknifes his body. Watch this, Dusty! Oh. But Quartermain is squashed. Strong splash from Eddie Guerrero, the 8-year veteran, over Buck Quartermain here on the prime.
Eddie Guerrero once again right here on WCW Prime proves one thing, that he possesses all the ability and skill to be a champion in any quarter, if you will, here with the big boys play. You see the big superplex off the top, and then, as my man Christopher Cruz said, the big jackknife splash. And he hooks the Quartermain in right here and takes a step to the pay window.
And we're back with tag team action featuring the Super Assassins in a moment. Back at the prime now, Chris Cruz and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes and Dusty. Time now for a debut of a brand new tag team called the Super Assassins, part of our prime match of the week. And they are a massive men.
Well, Christopher, legacy has been gave to a lot of great people, and that would be singers or whatever, but the word assassin, when it comes to mind to me, I'm telling you, brother, I know what the original, the main man assassin was like, and what all he put down. The Super Assassins, Assassins of the Nine, if they have anything that he possessed back there, I'm going to tell you what, they're going to be something to watch American males right here. It just happened to be our Moon match. It happened to be our Prime Cup match. It happened to be a new match with new guys, the Super Sessions, and they're getting ready for the Moon match of the week. And these boys got to be ready because this is going to be a big one with the American males. Are you ready for this?
Do it.
Okay, ready. This is a good one, too.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following feature contest, tag team action, is set for one fall. Introducing first, accompanied to the ring by Colonel Robert Parker, from parts unknown, the Super Assassins.
Well, just as we said at the outset, we have got a lot to learn about this team, and the fact is, I'll be honest with you, I've learned absolutely nothing so far except that. And I'm on the side of light with Robert Parker.
Well, I tell you what, Parker has guided some great teams and great individuals, if you will. And we're going to have a hardcore look at the Super Assassins.
Your opponents, Marcus Bedwell, Scotty Riggs, the American Males.
And the Males at one time held the World Tag Team Championship, so they certainly know what it is like to compete at the very highest level.
Looking at them guided by Colonel Parker, been very successful here in WCW. We're looking at the American males who have been World Tag Team Champions. You said Christopher Cruz. So right here is one of them cases to where some got a gear. You know what I mean? This is not a turning point, for the American males, but if the Super Sentry is going to get off the block, they got to get a victory here. I'm talking about a clean victory.
Dusty, you've got to be wondering what's going through the mind of the American males who have been absolutely unable to scout at all the Super Assassins who have just made their entrance here into World Championship Wrestling. They know nothing about them, whether they're competent in the ring or not, whether they're powerful, whether they're fast. They don't know anything about them.
Well, just like, let me say this though, just about that, okay? Just like there is a phone line to people that believe they're in the know, that never put on a pair of tights, that never wrestled, always want to be a promoter, they always want to be somebody, and all they do is write about what they think it should be. Well, there is also a phone line in the real world of professional wrestling that you call down, and you call somebody and say, have you heard of the Super Assassins? And that guy would say, yeah, they were down in Mexico, or they were somewhere, they were in Europe, and they possessed this and that. Believe me, the American males have a little a clue of what these guys are all about. I guarantee you that happened because you have to, because you lose here, Chris, as you said, right here, on the Prime, if they lose here, they're going to be way down the list. I'm talking about the American male.
Everybody,
that makes sense.
It makes a lot of sense. Excellent analysis and great insight into the inside of the often murky and mysterious world of professional wrestling. We often don't get a peek inside the world. And now the whip there by one of the Super Assassins on Scotty Riggs, who goes up. Oh, and Bagwell is going to help him. He brings him over. A version of a Frankensteiner. And look at Riggs. Letting loose. He goes for the one, the two. Oh, some power there on the part of the Super Assassins, who look to be very big men, Dusty.
Yeah, they good size, and they're not real around the middle heavy is what I'm saying. They look like they possess a lot of strength. But bottom line here, Parker's got a game plan for them, and already they're out of that game plan, and the American males can do that to you.
Now Scotty Riggs up. Double axe handle blow under the left arm of the Super Assassin, who had a look on his face you really need to do that?
Yeah, absolutely, because that'll break a socket. That'll tear your arm right out of socket right there.
The very quick tags, the trademark of the American males, brought them one time to the World Tag Team Championship, may bring them back. Bagwell, of course, in a previous incarnation, also held one half of the World Tag Team Championship.
Well, let me give you a little more insight while this thing is going on right here. You hear Parker giving that was one assassin, only one, the great assassin of past that I had so many battles with. And he was a huge man, about 280, you know what I mean? And he was quick as a cat. And there were times to where, of all the battles that I ever had, he was probably one of the most fierce competitors to ever wear a mask. And we haven't seen mask guys in a long time come to WCW. So hopefully here, by these guys even carrying the name of Assassin, that already tells me that they got to be pretty good. I'm telling you that. Parker would would not say, "Will you?" Or, you know, "You guys are super assassins." He looked for him and he found him. But they ain't doing too well right now.
The double shoulder block, and Riggs moves over, hooks the leg, gets just a one count. This appears to be the bigger of these two big super assassins. You're right, Dusty. Anyone in wrestling knows the history of the name Assassins, and you do not take that name lightly, as you just indicated.
No. He was the best masked man, I believe, more even in a way. Wrestling Tooth, I thought, was probably the best masked man, the destroyer of years gone by. And Wrestling Tooth and Assassin was the meanest and the baddest. And I'm going to tell you what, I had battles with him that I'm still hurting over.
Attempted a Larry. Oh, wait a minute. Some double teaming. Some might call that good teamwork on the part of the Super Assassins.
Well, they had to do something to turn the momentum around.
And that's exactly what they have done. And now Riggs and Bagwell seem to have lost it. And Riggs, it's real wobbly, real shaky right now. Can the Super Assassins capitalize on it? Whoa! Right into the big outstretched boot. We're at the Disney MGM Studios. It's our feature match this week on WCW Prime, our Prime Match of the Week. A pull of the hair there by Riggs. I beg your pardon, on Riggs by the Super Assassins. Oh, man, he drops him right to the small of his back.
Yeah, it seems now that they are being more methodical and they're taking their time and they're trying to stick to the game plan now that Colonel Parker has laid out for them, because they know the importance of this situation with the American male.
And time now for a two-minute break, but we'll be back with a completion of this match in a moment here on WCW Prime. Back here on WCW Prime with our Prime Cut Match of the Week. Chris Cruz and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, calling this feature action. The former World Tag Team Champs, the American Males, against the brand new team of the Super Assassins, Dusty.
While we were away, the Super Assassins really kept grinding and bumping right here and really staying to the new game plan. And they were bumping and grinding and really creating a situation here to where they might take a victory right here. And what a big victory it would be. Wow, what a shot.
Man, oh man. And Scotty Riggs may be out of it. Here comes one. Here comes two, and Bagwell in to rescue his young partner.
One thing for the fans to understand out there, when you're in there with a masked man, you don't really get an opportunity to see what kind of expressions he had, whether he's hurting or not, because he got that mask on. And that was one of the things Wrestling Tooth told me. He wore that because he didn't want to telegraph his thing to the opponent. Much like football now, you see the screens on the guys, the linebackers, because you don't want to see the eyes and stuff. So that mask comes into play for these guys.
Now there's the tag. Excellent analysis, because you're right, Dusty. You do kind of need to help. It does help to read the face of your opponent.
That's not clubbing. They have one fist apiece. That's two fists. That's two fists, not four fists on one guy. That wasn't clubbing. Super Assassins did not club a fan. I know the fans got their control things. They're going to run that back and everything, but they did not club her. That was not clubbing.
Now, that was not clubbering.
No, because if you've seen, if I had my telestrate, I could have said, "Stop it," right here. And Diane's working on that, and I could have showed you that it was the two fists clubbing.
I know it wasn't. I know what clubbering is after all these years. Months, days, weeks, hours, minutes, seconds. Scotty Riggs straight now over the top rope. He needs to take a flyer. He desperately needs to find Marcus Alexander Bagwell. And look out! Oh, wait a minute! He gets out of the way.
And hung up.
Eyes in the back of his head. Fantastic.
He needs to make that tag.
The fans here at the Disney MGM Studios try to help Scotty Riggs. He does it. And this time the referee sees it. And there's Bagwell. Right, left, right, left. He gets some speed. Oh, man, he flies. Here comes the pin. He's going to do it. 2.5.
Well, I'll tell you something that really happened right there in that situation. Exactly what happened. The Super Assassin standing out here on the inside did not come in. He did not waste any energy. He waited for his man to take the ball away from Bagwell, and that's just what happened. Great coaching, great teamwork. A little thing like that can turn a match around.
A big splash. Bagwell should do it. 1-2. No, a rescue there. All four men in the ring, but Scotty Riggs, he's had the stuffing beaten out of him. Oh, the double drop kick. And out goes one of the Super Assassins right outside the ring. We don't even know who the legal Super Assassin is, frankly.
He's the one with the yellow mask.
But thank you very much. The double hip toss.
Boy, he is up there high. What's he doing there?
He is high. Oh, wait a minute.
That was a headbutt there. What did he have something in his mask?
Look at this. And the switcheroo.
One, two, and three. No.
Hey, that's not the legal guy.
Wow. Shade of the original assassin.
Well, great teamwork. And look at Colonel Rob Parker.
What a find in. What a big victory right here on WCW Prime.
You got a lot of beef on the hoof here. You better be watching for them.
Wow. What a victory.
We'll see this again, Dusty. It wasn't fair at all.
Well, right here, the Super Assassins went to the game plan and got it hooked in real well and was taking the American males to task, if you will. And then we've seen a situation right here to where this Super Assassin come up here and laid into him right there in the temple where he had anything in his mask or not. And look here. The wrong guy, but they look just alike. Look like twins.
That was, as you call it, the switcheroo. And we're back here on the Prime right after these messages. All right, fans, that wraps it up for this week's edition of WCW Prime. Dusty, the Super Assassins defeating the former World Tag Team Champions. They're sending a message. They're here to stay.
Well, I tell you what, they had a great game plan there with, Colonel Parker laid out a situation for these guys. We've seen them. They were big and they were quick, and they seemed to really stick to the game plan. Got off a little slow, but ended up with a old switcheroo is what we talked about, that switcheroo. But Switcherooski was made famous by the Assassins and the original Assassins. But I know next week, we're getting close to holidays,
yes.
And I kind of get all melancholy. You know what I mean?
Melancholy?
Yeah, I get melancholy, and I start thinking about everything. And I've already talked to Breeze Wesler,
yeah.
And I got him out looking for a reindeer outfit.
Oh, for our Christmas show.
Yes.
Can't wait. And also, we've got
an outfit for you. I ain't going to tell you.
I can't wait.
Remember Sally Gooden?
No. We'll also have news about Starcade next week. I'm Chris Cruz for the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. We'll see you next week on The Prime.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
It's the ultimate challenge. Crossfire.
Crossfire. You get caught up in the crossfire.
Crossfire.
It's Godzilla, king of all monsters, against the baddest beasts of all time. It's all-out Godzilla war. Godzilla figures from Trendmasters. Godzilla rules.
Sharpen your sword for the ultimate high seas adventure. Battle bloodthirsty pirates and win a chance at a real-life treasure hunt. Cutthroat Island, based on the movie. Your treasure awaits from Acclaim.